All right, well, welcome to this week's Tokwa Ask Us Anything. As usual, it's been a busy week. In fact, for us, it's been 2 weeks since our last Ask Us Anything. In case anyone wondered what 2 weeks was.
How long do you think all that'll take?
2 weeks.
Really? Yeah, that's all.
Any idea when you're going to be finished here?
2 weeks.
How long will it take to put this place together?
2 weeks.
I do get the permits. How long will the job take?
2 weeks.
2 weeks? 2 weeks?
You sound like a parakeet there. 2 weeks? 2 weeks?
Well, 2 weeks. It's amazing.
Amazing nothing. It'll be a regular miracle.
So that's how long 2 weeks is. And that's as long as we haven't been on the air. But obviously, we've had quite a few things on the go, including last week we had a casual meetup. At the, where was it? People, someone?
7 Mile Bar.
7 Mile.
In Belcutta.
That's right. Fantastic. And that was a place actually suggested by Pete himself. So thanks for that, Pete. Now, obviously, we've had a lot of Tesla news. One of the things we've had is that Tesla has opened up some of the Netherlands superchargers to all EVs. And this is a pretty interesting sort of development. For those that are curious, you can actually see that on their finders page. So if you select superchargers open to non-Tesla, and there are about half a dozen, and they're all in the Netherlands. So this is a big development for Tesla. What it basically means is that they are on the verge of effectively opening up all of their supercharger sites to all EVs after the trial period, of course. And that's something that's obviously going to involve getting some bugs out of the system. The way you actually do charge another EV is just simply via the Tesla app with a login of your own, obviously without a car or a Tesla. And basically, there's a fee, the monthly fee, if you want a discounted daily rate of charging. And yeah, it'll be very interesting to see what sort of happens in the near future as far as that goes. Further to that, Tesla have got a new paint shop in Shanghai, and they've got a new video of it, which goes something like this.
Sometimes you need to get away from.
So that's pretty awesome. That's obviously of the Shanghai Gigafactory. And it's fantastic to see the progress at that place. Now, in further news, we've. Hey, I think you should step in here. Tesla has made the world's largest 12-day gain in the history of capital markets. They've basically added almost $400 billion. So perhaps you might like to explain what the hell's going on.
Well, we've given it all back last night, over the last couple of days as well.
But, yeah, they had the biggest drop in one day as well, didn't they?
Not in percentage terms, but yes, you're right, in dollar terms.
Dollar terms,
yeah. They dropped 12% and in one trading session last night. They have dropped as much as 20% before, I think. But it was presumably on the back of the Hertz announcement. So Hertz saying they were going to order 100,000 cars from Tesla. Elon was quite surprised as to why that would have moved the stock, because he said it should make no difference to Tesla's economics, because Tesla is supply constrained, not demand constrained. But there are other benefits. You know, the Hertz is already started a huge TV campaign with Tom Brady. Tom Brady's one of the well-known quarterbacks or NFL players in the US. He's actually owned a Model S for about 4 years. He's got a huge car collection, but he's had a Model S as his daily driver for about 4 years. Interestingly, Hertz had to pay the exact same price as you or I or anyone else walking off the street. So even though they purchased 100,000 cars, you think buying 100,000 cars would get you a discount, but not with the Tesla. So, that's a good photo there. So on the back of that, Tesla jumped over the $1 trillion valuation, overtook Facebook as the fifth or sixth largest company by market cap or listed stock in the US. And then just started a rally. So, you know, they got heaps of attention, quite a lot of media, and the stock ran up to 12.43, I think it was. That was the intraday high. And then Elon did another tweet and mentioned that, you know, because there's been a lot of talk in the US about, the Democrats are thinking about introducing what's called a billionaire's tax. I don't think it will see the light of day, but basically, you know, there's a way to get around paying taxes for someone like Elon, who doesn't take a salary from either SpaceX, Tesla, or anywhere else. His only compensation is his stock plan. And if he never sells the stock or he never exercises the option, he never gets taxed. But the last lot of options that he that are expiring in August of next year, the strike price or the exercise price is $6.43. So he's got the rights to buy those shares at $6.43, and they're trading over $1,000 now. So when he exercises those shares, he'll have to pay about $14 billion odd tax, because that won't be taxed as a capital gain. It'll be taxed as ordinary income. So you'll actually have to pay 53% tax. But he's used that as an opportunity to put up a Twitter poll to say, should I sell my shares to pay tax? And I think it was 58% people voted yes, and about 40-odd% voted no. And so he said, whatever the result is, I'll abide by it. So Tesla trades on average about 22 million shares. That's been the average over the last 3 months. So I think he traded about 50-odd or 60-odd million shares last night. There's a good chance that he sold all his shares last night.
It's actually been trading at 50 and 60 million for a few days.
Correct. But he's only got roughly about 20 million shares to sell, which would be roughly about 10%, which would give him enough to pay his taxes. He could then go back in and use that cash to buy more Tesla stock, or he could just sit on it. If I was him, I'd just sit on it. It's about $12 billion of cash that he'll have up his sleeve. Last time Tesla did a capital raise, I think they only raised, do you remember, Harold? Was it about $8 or $10 billion, somewhere around there?
I think you're muted, Harold. Yeah, I think it was something like that.
Yeah, so if he's got 12 billion sitting in cash, he can just, you know, set that up as a rainy day fund. And, you know, should Tesla need to, should they get in trouble again or should they ever need to raise cash? Well, he can just do it all himself. So, which is quite incredible. I just think the stock, is a gross overreaction. You either think that, you know, the run up to 1243 was overdone, in which case this has just come back to where it should be. I just think it's just been a huge overreaction. All anyone can think about at the moment is Elon selling his shares. In fact, Rob Mao did a very good job and mentioned that there's actually much more important news, such as Tesla's deliveries out of Shanghai at 54,000 last month. And, you know, October, they had a week's worth of holidays as well. So that's a huge number. So I bought some shares, more shares last night and more this morning. So
actually, Pete,
not advice. You've got to press your not advice button.
Probably appropriate to do something like this. And that worked really well. So I'm going to try that again.
The following segment is general in nature and shouldn't be taken as personal professional advice. Listeners should seek their own independent assessment from a qualified advisor and not rely on the general nature of information in this program.
So there you have it. So
you should really play that at the very beginning. You hit record and you play that.
Well, actually, there's probably another little ditty I need to play as well, which is something like this.
Viewers are advised that this recording may contain references to Synergy, 2 weeks, and Grimes. Anyone triggered by these or similar phrases should press pause and subscribe to the Nissan Leaf channel.
2 weeks! 2 weeks! Come on, Jared, join in.
2 weeks? Really?
Yeah, that's all. Any idea when you're going to be finished here?
2 weeks.
How long will it take to put this place together?
2 weeks. I do get the permits. How long will the job take?
2 weeks.
2 weeks? 2 weeks? You sound like a parakeet there. 2 weeks? 2 weeks?
Yes. So anyway, enough of that. We've actually got some more news. Let's have a look. So we did the Elon Musk sell 10%. Yes, vintage Model S and Model X owners are to get new autopilot cameras, which is basically to facilitate the FSD, the full self-driving package that they bought, some of them quite a few years ago.
So that's those up to 2017 models, isn't it?
Yes, I think it was September or October 2017.
September 2017 rings a bell. Yep.
And paid for full self-driving.
And have paid FSD, exactly right. That's right.
And you get 7 out of your 8 cameras swapped out. So I'm not sure. I think it's the re-one that stays the same, does it?
Yes, because that's been colored. It's a lot less important than the other cameras, which is an interesting step that they've actually gone to that. It's probably got to do with more to do with color recognition than anything else, because I think the actual cameras are pretty much the same, sensitivity-wise.
The other interesting thing was that they can do it by coming out to your house and it only takes an hour to an hour and a half to replace the cameras, which just goes to say something for the technology and the thinking behind the making of the car in the first place, that they can do something simple like that.
Yeah, absolutely. I've actually taken one of my repair cameras out or replaced it, and that didn't take long at all. And I ended up doing it twice because I had to do some tests and work out how to do it right the second time, which sort of is a bit like the doctor in the house when he installs some of his accessories. But we'll get to that
We always add an extra 10 minutes with the doctor because he likes to go through the ashtray and the glove box for loose change. And that's just part of his nature. So
that's
same right. Times.
Oh, funny guy.
Probably a good time just to ask anyone that is new to ask us anything to please say hello. And feel free to do that by simply shouting out.
Hi. Hi, Mark here.
Okay, Mark, how are you going?
Yeah, good, thanks. Just getting a one of the new standard range pluses. Just found out it's going to be a unicorn. It's going to have the long range battery, but still 5.6 seconds acceleration. So I've got the old motor, but the new battery.
Oh.
Surprised me as well when I went down to the showroom to ask, because I'd heard rumours about them. So that's an interesting one. It'd be interesting to get it.
Absolutely. So is that implying that the greater capacity cars, the more modern versions of those, not yours, will have a smaller motor?
I don't know if it's a smaller motor. We didn't actually wouldn't sort of say anything else on that, but it's a different motor. So because it's slower, you would tend to think it's actually got less kilowatts, you would think.
Yeah.
So I don't know.
Might have something to do with the efficiency of the different motor, hence its longer range. But I think the new ones are a few kilos heavier as well, aren't they?
Yeah, they are, because they've got more batteries.
The LFP batteries, and they filled it right out. But it may be a slightly more efficient motor.
That's what I'm wondering. I'm wondering whether it's that one's slightly more efficient. I may find that although I've got the 5.6 seconds and the bigger battery, I won't get the full 491 is what I'm thinking, which is the WLTP, I think. Because the old one, I think, was only... I know you won't know. What I mean is that's WLTP. I think the one was 446, was it? Or 448, something like that. So I'm guessing that I might have got somewhere in the middle between the two because I've got the faster motor. Just a guess. No idea. One question I'd like to ask, one is, any ideas of who the best people to insure Teslas are?
RAC yes. and Budget Direct are probably the two best people to try from.
Budget Direct and who, sorry, Pete?
RAC and Budget Direct.
Oh, RAC are pretty good for Teslas, are they?
They are, yes.
Yeah, they are.
Right. Yep.
They have a big discount for electric vehicles.
Right.
Yes.
And charging stations too. That's good, 20% off.
Right. So is there any preference between Budget Direct and RAC? It sounds like RAC, because I mean I'm an RAC member, so
get a quote from both.
Yeah.
Get a quote, but I'll just go with that.
Yep.
Is there any advantage anyone's found with the RAC? Maybe better cover itself or
it is slightly more comprehensive. And the biggest difference from what I remember is if you have someone else driving your car, RAC is fairly unrestricted, whereas I know a lot of the other insurers, your driver's got to be over 21 or over 24 or what have you, whereas RAC is fairly unrestricted, I think.
Right, fair enough.
And Mark, some bit of advice from the guy at the road. He's got a Tesla same as mine, and someone cleaned him up, and it took 3 months for them to repair it, and he had not ticked the box for a rental car.
Okay.
So I
Right.
Cost me $65 for a year, so that was well worth it.
Oh, $65 is that with the RAC?
Yep.
Yeah. Right. Yeah, I've got the RAC and I tick that box.
Right, I will bear that, especially if they're going to take that long to repair. That might be worthwhile. What's the situation with charging cables with them? Then what they come with? Do I need any extra ones for going to like shopping centres? Like I know Joondalup Shopping Centre has some charging stations there, but there are no cables on them.
Yeah, so for the Joondalup one, you'll need what's called a Type 2 to Type 2 cable.
Right.
It's interesting. So I use my Type 2 cable, twice, three times a week. There's others who live south of the river who hardly ever use their Type 2 cable. So it all depends on what charger you're likely to use. But, yeah, that's probably a good one. You can borrow one free from the club once you're a financial member. And and just play around with it and see how much use you'll get out of it. And then you can make the decision as to whether it's worthwhile buying one or not. That's the main cable that you might need for charging in the metro area. Once you go out of Perth, you might want to think about a 32 amp or three phase 32 amp, 5-pin charger. So you can either get what's called a pigtail for your UMC. Yeah. UMC stands for Universal Mobile Connector. That's the square box that you'll get with your car. And so that will have a 10 amp and a 15 amp tail. So you can, for about $150, you can get a three-phase 32 amp tail. Alternatively, you can get a what's called a cones charger. The cheapest you can find them on the internet is about $1,350. But
$1,300.
Yeah, but the club. So Harold's got some where we've bought them as a in bulk for wholesale prices. Talk about being a non-for-profit. Harold doesn't put any margin or anything on top of that. So you'll get that for $750 if you get that through the club. And it only costs you $20 for an annual membership. So
I'm already a member. I've already paid that.
Fantastic. So
joined already.
So you get your $20 back multiple times over fairly quickly. The advantage of that cable is you can then get a three-phase socket installed in your garage, and you can keep that. So the difference between that and the pigtail is that will let you charge at the full AC rate of 11 kilowatts, which, so yours is a standard range, so roughly about 80 kilometers an hour, a little bit over 80 kilometers an hour in terms of charging, whereas the pigtail will only give you roughly about 7.6, so roughly about 50 kilowatt kilometers an hour. The other advantage is that what you can do is you can have a socket installed, which should only cost you a couple of $100s, depending on how long the cable run is.
Yeah, I've already got, I've just ordered the Tesla charger, the Gen 3.
Okay, excellent. Yep. So then you'll always have your UMC in the car.
Yeah.
So the problem with people that just rely on the UMC to charge at home is quite often they'll be out of the house and realize they've left the UMC at home. Yeah, so I've made it a point to always leave it in the frunk.
Yeah. Right, that sounds brilliant.
And the other side of the coin is I've done 38,000 Ks and I've never had my UMC in my car except when I go bush, because the car's full. Plugging in every night is full. Or plug it in.
Yeah.
I don't even plug it in at night. I just use my solar during the day. So I've never had my UMC in my car except when I go traveling. So it's another side of the coin. Because I use my front for washing, for my shopping and stuff. Not washing, shopping.
Shopping.
Yeah. I've got a power. No, I put a powered front on mine, so it's very convenient for shopping. So
I've heard of those that people, but mine comes with the powered trunk. The trunk, which they didn't used to apparently. I've heard about the powered, or seen the powered fronts. They look really, really specky. Also, the powered handles as well, door handle kits.
Yeah, that's a big install, that one.
That's a big one, yeah. But also, about $750 American. That's just for the bits, and then you've got to install it. So,
just a note on the auto front, there is a group buy currently on a Tesla group on Facebook. I did actually post it on the Tokwa Facebook group, but it hasn't been approved yet. So I'm not sure how they're going to, if you want to approve that or not. But they're currently, the EV offer one, they're currently offering 20% off for group buy if they can get 20 units or more into Australia. Otherwise, it's a 10% discount. So it's a pretty big discount.
What's that on, Chris? What?
The EV, they used to be called Tesla offer, but now they're called EV offer. I think they're obviously broadening, expanding to other cars.
Sorry, which part was that for? Was that for the front?
The auto front, yeah.
Okay, yeah.
How much is it, Chris?
Carmen. So it's normally, I think, $549. I can probably share my screen. Yeah. It's normally $549 US. And I think after the 20% discount, it's about $400 US. So it's roughly about $600 Australian.
Richard, the Han show was a bit less than that, wasn't it? Yeah. Do you remember how much you paid?
It wasn't that much.
Yeah.
It's got a few more things over the hand show, though. It's got like the landing detection and a few other things.
What's the landing detection, Chris?
So basically it can identify whether the frunk has been locked or not. So just in case it hasn't. And I think the Henshaw one doesn't have the override cable at the front, and this one comes with the override, so you can actually disable the unit if it ever malfunctions.
It does have an override cable.
Does it?
You can't close it from the front screen. You can only open it.
I think the older ones probably didn't have it.
And in terms of the landing feature that you mentioned, I've had it. I've closed it a couple of times when I had my head stuck in there, and all it does is just once it senses pressure, it just stops pressing down. So, and either goes back up or stays where it is. And you can actually just forcibly override it with your hand, and then just close it again, and it will work perfectly fine.
Okay, but yeah, that's the one I'm looking at anyway.
Yeah, my one of those arrived yesterday. Took 3 weeks to get here, but I went for that one because, as you said, it's got that landing protection, which the Henshaw doesn't. So you've got the risk that it's not properly closed and you don't know with the Henshaw. And I saw a lot of video reviews, and the Henshaw, people were raving about it, but then they were updating their videos and saying, no, don't buy it. I had to get rid of it. I've replaced it with the EV offer one. So that's why I went with that one. Arrived yesterday, going to install on the weekend.
Yes, yeah, so I've heard also one. From the same. Two of my mates who did have the Henshaw one, they ended up getting the EV offer one. Yeah. Simply because one of them had malfunctioned and they wanted the landing feature. So he basically persuaded me to get the EV offer one as well.
Yeah, I'd agree.
Interesting. Someone else that is new, please say hello, Bruce.
Oh, yeah, Bruce and Kathy. We bought a Tesla Model 3 Standard Range Plus about 2 months ago, 3 months ago, which we've been loving, driving that around. We joined Tokwa at the same time. So this is our first Wednesday chat. We thought we'd show up and hear what's going on. But we do have one question. It's about what is the status or the future of bi-directional charging to use your car to connect to the house.
That would be nice.
Status is zero. That's it's between Buckley's and none.
There's been an update on that, Harold. I think it's about 2 weeks away.
Yeah, it's 2 weeks. I thought, Harold,
definitely 2 weeks away. That one, Harold,
it is 2 weeks.
They announced it today. Federal government going to install on themselves.
I'll give Scott a call.
He can do Saturday mornings too if you need
If he's not in Hawaii.
You don't want to ruin your weekend.
The actual answer to your question is when Sandy Munro pulled the battery pack apart, he found that it had diodes that were non-bi-directional, so certainly the early Model 3s, it's never going to happen. Later ones, maybe, but certainly not the early ones.
Okay, so the earlier ones definitely is not possible. Not
possible.
The recent ones.
And your current one would not be possible because people regularly pull apart the batteries in crashed Model 3s, which sort of crash distressingly often. So there's always a fresh Model 3 to be looked at. And basically, as Richard said, one of the stages for it to be bi-directional has to have transistors, and in Tesla's case they've got diodes, so it's strictly a one-way travel of energy flow into the battery through the charger and not out of it. So it's not until or if Tesla do that you could ever think of vehicle to grid or vehicle to home in any sort with your car or with a Tesla. And it's one of these things, a lot of the regulators and a lot of the energy companies love it. They love the idea of using people's batteries as battery storage. The problem is any battery that's on wheels is exceedingly expensive compared to the stationary storage equivalent. So it just doesn't make a lot of sense to consume battery cycles in your car for the sake of load displacement of your house, when you could just go and buy a purpose-built stationary battery that's cheaper and always available.
And you have that you have that possible double coincidence in that the time that you'll need to draw on the car's battery might be when the grid's down or there's some sort of a, you know, some if there's a fire or some sort of a act of God event. So you've used up the power in your battery in your car, and now because of some sort of an emergency, you need to flee, and you've got no juice in your car battery. So,
Yeah, all right. So it's a number of reasons. Yeah. It can't be done physically, but it's probably not a good idea in any case.
Apparently, it was in the Tesla Roadsters, the first generation Roadsters, and Elon said that, you know, they all had them and no one ever used them. You used the discharging of the battery into the house.
Yeah, but it was before its time. But it's ruining my weekend at the moment because I can't take my induction cooker with me and go and have a nice little camp somewhere and run it off the car.
Speaking of weekends, does anyone want to tell us about the federal government EV policy that was announced? I think it was yesterday.
Yeah, it was $250 million all up. There's about 50,000 home chargers that they're going to be supporting. They're going to be supporting fleets. I can't remember off the top of my head how many public chargers. Was it 1,200?
Oh, yeah, or something like that, yes. Yep.
Yeah. Matt Keane put it very well. He's the state MP out of New South Wales. He's a EV supporter. He's actually a Liberal. He put it into context. He said that what the federal government is doing is only a fraction of what New South Wales is doing. So, and that's, you know, that's a federal plan compared to a state plan. So he was on the 7:30 report. I've shared it on Twitter, but yeah, pretty good interview, that one.
Yeah, cool. Okay, well, we're still going to news.
Sorry, Harold, it was 1,000 public charges, not 1,200.
1,000.
And 400 businesses and 50,000 households and $250 million in funds all up.
And that's over, what, 60 years they're spreading that money?
Yeah. By 2050, Jared. By 2050. Yeah.
2 weeks, isn't it? 2 weeks.
2 weeks, no. That's the insulation rate, 2 weeks.
Yeah. Actually, Richard Chapman, I don't know if he's online, but he shared a hilarious thing on his Facebook today. It was a guy who's committed to giving up drinking by 2050. Giving up alcohol by 2050. It was absolutely hilarious. So can you guys see, is Richard on? I'll see if I can find the post and share it.
I have it right here. Following away in the background.
Tell us about it.
Cracking up. No, can you find it? I can't get to it right now.
All right, you guys talk amongst each other. I'll see if here we go. Found it. Man announces he will quit drinking by 2050. I don't know if we've got time to read the whole thing out, but I'll give it a quick crack.
Oh, yeah, you do. Go for it.
Yeah, we got time.
Feel free to copy it and send it. I saw it somewhere else. And
not even midnight yet. Well. Keep going.
Yeah, early 12s, mate.
The problem is it's really small writing, but I'll try my best. Actually, I better put the brightness up. Sorry, getting a bit old now. Cineman has an ambitious target to phase out his alcohol consumption within the next 29 years as part of an impressive plan to improve his health. The program will see Greg Taylor, who's 73, continue to drink as normal for the foreseeable future before reducing consumption in 2049 when he turns 101. He has assured friends it will not affect his drinking plans for the short or medium term. Taylor said it was important not to rush the switch to non-alcoholic beverages, it's not realistic to transition to zero alcohol overnight. This requires a steady, phased approach where nothing changes for at least two decades, he said. I've got to try and zoom in now.
Wasn't there something about a fridge as well?
Yeah. Adding that he may need to make additional investments in beer consumption in the short term to make sure no night out is worse off. Taylor will also be able to bring forward drinking credits earned from the days he wasn't drunk over the past 40 years, meaning the actual end date for consumption may actually be 2060. To assist with the transition, Taylor has bought a second beer fridge, which he describes as the capture and storage method.
So that was genius. I thought that's getting a share.
That was brilliant.
That is hilarious. Absolutely hilarious. Right. So, in the meantime, we've also had iDrive. That was on last Thursday, I think. And quite a few people in the room had the pleasure of driving a lot of people around. So perhaps you would like to talk to that. I know, Pete, you were there, and Jared.
Nigel was there too.
Yep. Nigel.
Nigel.
And Jared, yep.
Yep, Richard Cooper.
And Richard.
Yeah, I wasn't driving people around this year, unlike last year. I was just had me bonnet and boot open and doors open so people could look at it.
And also that apparently your radio's stuck on ABC and they said you couldn't go on the track.
Yes, yes, yeah, I kept falling asleep.
Yeah, I thought it was something like that. They said that was, you couldn't go on the track because the ABC.
But it was a great day. There was about 300 people that registered for a drive and 250 that ended up actually going for a drive.
Yeah, and many some of them went about three times, didn't they?
Exactly. Yeah, yeah. Many of them did, yeah. So, yeah, and got some good footage, Harold, but I may have to speak to the people involved as to whether we're able to put it online first. I have to get their permission.
Cool. No worries.
It was definitely a good day. There were certainly lots of people that didn't realise that the Tesla can go fast. They was very excited when they went down the track at 100 k's, I think it was an hour. Very quickly. 110.
110.
Yeah. Allegedly.
Allegedly. And yeah, the people that I had in my car, they loved it. They just were so rapt. I mean, just see their response from when you put your foot down. They just had no idea that the car could do that. And they couldn't, that feeling. And it's the same feeling that, you know, we see all the time when people get into it. And they just couldn't believe the cornering and the handling of the car. They thought it was great. So I thought it was a very good day, actually. I really enjoyed it.
So Rob had a lot to do with organising that, as did Florian, obviously. But, yeah, it was a great day.
I had a ball. Every person I took out said, are you happy if I go fast? And they went, oh, yeah. So I did. And I got a performance. And I used to race that car. I used to race my Lotus on that track. So it's been a while since I've been back. And yeah, 110, yeah, I just slipped past that a couple of times.
Yeah, I saw Richard just about 160 a couple of times.
No, if it wasn't for the chicane, I would have done that, but no, there was a chicane in the way.
It was 106.
Sorry, yeah, 106.
Yeah. So, it was a really good day. I thought it was well organised. I thought Rob did a really good job marshalling all the cars. Getting him on the track, because that was a pretty impressive job, just to get all those cars rotating pretty quickly.
No, there was one blue that wasn't rotating very quickly. I reckon he almost made 30 kilometres an hour and I was following him. Oh, my God.
Yeah, some of the people that were driving that took the car, that started driving, that's when it became a bit of a hazard.
Especially that guy with all the advertising on his car, he was really slowing me down. So Jürgen did some VIP laps around midday, and he had the track to himself and took a few people for a uh,
for a run, and I saw a few people getting out of his car and walking with their legs a fair way apart. So it looked like they had some extra deposits in their pants on the way out. Yeah, extra luggage, excess luggage.
No, it was a very good day. A couple of people that got in my car were really all over Tesla. Like, they just knew everything. They were quoting me so many things. Like, these people have obviously watched every YouTube, read every story about it, but never been in a Tesla. Mm-hmm. But they were, you know, asking me hundreds of questions, and I was like, I couldn't answer some of them. I just go see Rob, go see Pete. They'll answer them, but they really wanted to know more and more about the car. But once they got in it and they felt it, that was a mind-blowing thing for them. And one of the ladies that I had in my car, she was from the road safety trauma, and she was, you know, asking me how many airbags are in the car and how safe is it and all these kind of questions. And I said, do you want to feel the power a bit? And she said, yeah, that'd be fine. And she was completely taken back by it once it took off, completely. And she was, yeah, she thought it was fantastic. So, you know, so it was, yeah, it was a very good day. So I missed Alex. Alex wasn't there. So that's the sad part.
I know. Sorry. I had work that day.
I know.
I have a job.
I know. You know.
You've got to work at least one day a month, Alex, to get by. So.
I know.
We're all going to do it.
I thought you lived off your royalties, Alex.
Oh, I should have. I know. I have. Just I'm needed so much this time of year. It's our busiest time. Car air conditioning.
You're needy this time of year, are you?
Needed. I'm needed.
Oh, needed. All right. Not needy. Okay. Cool. Good to know. Good to
know. Oh, and Paul. Paul did a really good job too. So,
oh yeah,
spark joy. Paul was really working hard, and I believe it's his second time he's done it. So, good work, Paul.
Fantastic. And then one of our penultimate pieces of news is the EV muster at Darren. Again, Pete, and I think in the room we're at this. I regrettably wasn't.
Sharing your screen, not the what you should be sharing, Harold.
Yeah, wrong screen share, Harold.
Yep.
We missed your credit card number. Do it again.
Oh, we got it.
That was his homework.
You get that when you sign up to Talkware, don't you?
Yeah. And also, Harold, I changed your points thing, so I'm getting more points now from your card.
Cool.
I changed the plan, so.
So is that better?
That's better.
The one.
Got love Zoom. So this is the Darren EV muster. And in fact, the car that I think Pete mentioned earlier was this one right here.
The one with the big Tokwa symbol, logo on it.
The roof,
yeah.
And I think Pete's done a couple of little stats. You may want to talk to this, Pete.
Are you posting it up? Oh, cool.
Yes.
So which one's this? This one's by brand. This is
muster by brand.
Sorry, Harold, you've got the old one. I actually made a boo-boo on that one. So let me see if I can get the updated one up.
Someone's getting sacked tonight. They're gone.
Yeah.
Someone's...
Where are we?
Yeah, let me stop sharing and you can share the real one because...
I'm trying to share it from my phone, but let me try it again now. Sorry. Here we go. Okay, so I just got to go share content and it's this one. Can you see that now?
No. You will in a moment.
Okay, so yeah, in the top left-hand corner. So... Yeah, it was a WA record. So well done to John Edwards for he organised the last record in WA and again this one in Darren. So there was 66 cars there that we ended up counting. And
you know, it was at least 66 EVs, including one Harley Davidson Livewire. There was actually another EV bike there, but that came on a trailer, so I didn't count that one. But as you can see, yeah, most of the cars, 70% of them were Teslas. And what's quite interesting about these stats, although it's probably not a statistically significant sample size, it is fairly representative of what we see out there. So with the Hyundai's being the second most prominent EV. In terms of the models, that's the chart straight underneath. Yeah, the Model 3 had 60% of the lion's share, with the Kona being the second most popular. In terms of color, once again, that just shows Tesla's dominance with the white, that being the only free color. So the Model 3s, most of them were white. And interestingly, and this is probably not representative of what we see out there in the wider EV community, so this probably highlights the fact that a lot of people there were EV enthusiasts. But yeah, about 45% of the number plates were customized or personalized number plates, which was just a interesting tidbit.
No tweaks then, Jared.
I'm trying to limit myself at the moment. You know, I'm stealing Phil for Pete. He's obviously working outside again. He's putting the doghouse again. So,
I
it was a very well-run day.
And I'm going to get a GoFundMe page going for you, Pete.
I said to my wife, I said, "What's that?"
I was going to say, Pete, I was wondering when you did the count, because on my way into town, I was probably a bit late. It might have been 12:30, 12:45 before I got there. On the way into town, I saw at least two or three Teslas leaving town already.
And that's actually a very good point. I was speaking to Shane Parker, who mentioned that he was coming into town at 12:30.
That's
and
me.
There you are.
That's me, bro.
Yeah, so there you are. So why didn't you mention it? Why didn't you mention how you were coming in at 12:30 and saw three others leaving town?
Yeah, I did. What do you mean?
You are allowed to elaborate, but...
Well, yeah, it was just 12:30 or so. I come into town and, I don't know, just the last 10 Ks or so, I reckon I passed three of them heading out of town. Then I hit town and saw the pub, and there was like, I don't know, half a dozen cars parked by the pub. And I sort of thought, well, either it's been a really shit turnout or I'm in the wrong place.
So sure.
And kept looking.
So the plan was that we were all going to have lunch at 12 o'clock, and then we were all going to come back for a photo shoot or a photo lineup at 1:30. So some people went to the pub between 12 and 1:30, and some people had lunch on site. But to answer your question, Barry, so Rob came up to me and said, look, we've had four people do counts and everyone's got a different number. He said, can you go and do a count yourself? So I thought, well, what I'll do is I'll just take a photo of every number plate. And then I went through it at home, and that's how I got the stats. So I had 66 unique number plates. So I know there was at least 66 cars there and potentially two or three others. So definitely that second motorbike or e-bike. There was also a scooter, but I didn't count those two because, you know, they didn't get there on their own power. So, but yeah, there could have potentially been two or three others.
And he's made sure he's sold that information or those photos to a foreign party that will investigate looking into your car later on. So with the self-driving thing, so you'll be fine. It's no issue.
Actually, we had the police turn up. And James Taylor, I don't know if James is online today, but yeah, he took one of the officers for a run, and he because they had to stay together in case there was a emergency or something, so he had the pursuit car behind him, and they played along. They were really good sports. They turned the sirens on, and yeah, it was pretty cool.
Wasn't the point of this Dowring muster to look at getting John Edwards' biofuel things across the Nullarbor How successful was that?
Very successful.
Yeah.
Sorry?
Yeah, go on, Rob.
Yeah.
Elaborate.
The guy that owns the three roadhouses across the Nullarbor, he came back three times, and he got to take James Taylor's Tesla for a drive. He was very impressed. So they were having a meeting the next day with the directors of the roadhouses.
So it was a pretty impressive day, and I think those stats of Pete's are quite informative, I think, at the end of the day. Absolutely. But to get there, and it was really well set up, and to have power already organised, I think that was just brilliant. It was so well done. And to me, the power was a real bonus at the end.
Absolutely. Robin, you guys slept, was it at 2J the night before, and to get there first thing in the morning? So, yeah, hat off to you guys. You were there from, I think you were one of the first ones to get there, probably, were you?
Yeah, we were there. We were there first at 9 o'clock to check all the plugs out, make sure they were working. So there was only two of the 20. There's actually 22 different three-phase plugs at that site.
22.
Yeah, and three of them weren't working.
And there's probably a couple of hundred 10 and 15 amp, other power points there as well. Just in that shed, there was on the other side of the oval. I count a 26 just in that shed.
You right there, Pete?
Yeah. Right.
It's going bad.
Is he in the doghouse again?
He's been.
My wife chasing me around with a broom. Only kidding.
Yeah, there you go.
I'm just going to have a break for 10 minutes and I'll see you soon.
He's got a loose cow in his yard. We'll sort it out. Okay. It's got me going on.
I told my wife this would happen. I told her she needs to let me have the living room. Otherwise, I'll get accused of being in the doghouse.
For those that aren't certain why Pete might be in the doghouse. Actually, we might just wait for Pete to come back so we can explain it properly.
While waiting for Pete, maybe Carmen, you could talk to Mark, who's a new gentleman.
Oh, yes.
About your experience with your new insurance company, the Czechoslovakian Russian border company that you're using now. Is that right? The one with insurance? Because Mark's looking for insurance.
Otherwise known as budget insurance, and it's general. It's underwritten by General Motors, and I was able to do it lower than $1,000 compared to $1,700 quoted by RAC.
Which is I don't think the RAC like you, Carmen, because mine was half that price.
I have written to the CEO, but I haven't got a response yet. I'm hoping he actually received my letter. There are other people that have been overquoted as well, and it's something to do with the sales department. I think some new people have taken over and their marketing, depending on how they feel on the day, although I tried on different days and I still got the same response. But my insurance includes a hire car in the event of an accident. It includes replacement to the same model if a write-off within 2 years. And what else? Second driver nominated. So it's pretty good.
Mm. I might also say...
That sounds excellent.
So I'm with RAC. My Model 3 is 2 years old and it's insured for $100,000 and it cost me $850 plus $65 to do the maths, $900 and something.
Which is amazing.
Tell us who you got.
RAC.
Now I'm RAC as well. Mine was $850, although I didn't tick the box. It was $850, but there was no marketing because I just did it online.
Yeah.
Call to anyone.
Yeah. Mine was RAC and it was 920, I think.
Yeah.
Were we all previously with RAC?
Yeah. No. I was with SGIO and they wanted $4,500.
I've just got a quote from SGIO and that's 1700.
Oh no, that would
much 16 something.
But that's with $8.
Yeah.
Well, the problem was that RAC would only insure it for 56,000 and I paid 81 less than a year ago at the time when I got the quote. And I would have paid a little bit more than other insurances had they insured it for a reasonable value. But they said they can't. They can only look at the red book. And I said, it doesn't apply to EVs. And that is incorrect. So I have sent a copy of the renewal that they gave me. The first time I actually paid $1,200. The first year when I first got it, not knowing any different. And the second, the renewal was 1750. So I didn't do it. And I talked to the person in charge of sales, Jackie, and she wouldn't budge. So I said, all right, well, I won't be insuring it at that price. And I do have my home insurance and I do have 60% no claim bonus. So I haven't got to the bottom of it, but that's what they offered. And it just wasn't worth taking.
When we got our car, as I said, it was a couple of months, beginning of September, we paid $932 insurance with RAC. But I was on the phone to them for about an hour. And when they quoted me on the phone, it was going to be about $100-$150 more. And then I suddenly realized and stop that conversation. If you book online, it's much cheaper. Where you'll save $100-$150 by doing it online.
I did both.
Yeah.
Don't ring them up. That's
so that's obviously me too.
I'm going to have to play with that, obviously.
Yeah. I did look into your policy, Carmen. Yeah. Under the car, there's a bit of a
and it included a driver.
No. The car isn't actually a car. It's a tractor. You do get the bottle of vodka with it, so it's a part of the deal. So it's still good. Better than the RAC, that's for sure. So.
Yeah.
You get a Dear John letter with that. Sorry, a John Deere letter with that.
Very good.
A champagne comedy around here tonight.
Well, quick, you've got a Model 3, haven't you, Carmen?
Sorry?
It's yours, a Model 3.
It's a Model 3, yes, standard.
Yeah. Do you find it requires window tinting or not?
No. And I do have I bought from Tesla in Osborne Park from Harry, the shades for the sunroof interior. And they're terrific. I also bought the boot liner and mats. so I don't have a problem, no.
Right, that's worth it. I'll just see how I go this summer then with it, see if I need tint or not. That's great.
Can I
just say something about tinting there?
Yeah.
Sorry, Jared.
I was just going to say that a lot of people ask me questions about when they got in the car and everyone asked the same question, does the roof get hot? And I'm like, well, touch it. Yeah, it's going to get hot, but it doesn't affect inside the car, but go put your hand on a car that's got a normal roof, see if it gets hot. It's the same thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I was just thinking more, but I haven't got as much hair on my head as yours, and I do feel the heat a bit more on the top of it.
Mark.
That's not just the light.
Mark, you do not need to tint the roof.
Yeah.
Number one, glass on its own stops 98% of the UV, but they've got some tinting in the glass to cut out virtually all UV. So you won't get sunburn. Number two, with the infrared that radiates from the roof, if you put your hand up there, yes, it feels hot. Now, I actually sit quite high up in my car and I haven't even got that much gap between me and the roof. I sit up quite high and I do not feel the heat radiating, and I've got very little covering on the top here.
Yes, you're right, the same now, as me.
And Mark, what suburb are you in, mate? I'm just a
Kinross.
Kinross, okay.
So tinting of the side windows is a purely aesthetic thing.
I totally disagree. Because if I've always had tinted windows, and if it's a sunny day beating in on my shoulder, I put the windows up and the sun goes away. Couldn't disagree with you more on that one.
I'd never have a car without a side window. Everybody's experience is different there, Richard. Yeah, I don't feel anything because I'm stupid. You know, no sense, no feeling. So we've got to wait and see how Mark's stupidity level is after he's owned it.
Well, my golfer had to put the tint in because I just found it too hot, especially my wife on the passenger side for going on holidays, usually on that side. She was getting a lot of the sun first thing in the morning and she was used to get too hot, and found the 3M window tinting was excellent.
Yeah, Mark?
Yeah?
I think you'll do it from your own personal point of view. I'm with Carmen. Yeah. I've got a liner over the front glass.
Yeah.
And it also has a, not just the mesh, but has a liner as well. And I didn't even bother taking it out of a winter. For me, it's much more comfortable. Obviously, I'm more sensitive than Nigel. And I have the side windows tinted and also have the back window tinted the same as the side windows. And I think it looks good and it certainly keeps us cooler.
You're obviously hot stuff, Steve, and you've got that little bit of covering to keep that thermal management going.
Mark, I've just got a quote for Standard Range Plus and all that sort of stuff. I don't know all your details, but $818.61.
All right.
That's if you live in Kinross and you've got all the other stuff. Yeah.
Did you take in Mark's record that he has spent 3 years for armed robbery and he's just out of prison? So did you put that in there? Or
you said you wouldn't say about that, not for the second meeting.
It's only going to, that's right. It's going to, they'll wait till next week, Mark. It'll be fine.
And what's the replacement value?
Oh, that was just Standard Range Plus.
No replacement.
Yeah, but how much?
Agreed value, 55.7.
Yeah, well, why would you do that?
Yeah.
That's too short.
So how much does the Standard Range Plus cost?
It's 66 start before you do anything.
Oh, they've gone up, have they? Oh, right, because they used to be 59.
Yeah, 66,403.
There you go.
What was that?
Have you got a long range, Carmen?
No, 66,403. I don't have a long range.
Is it possible they're not insuring for the GST because they won't have to pay it or something technical like
that? The only cost of stamp duty. So it's a $59,000 is the actual cost of the car plus stamp duty and whatever.
It's actually
$60,000.
It's $59,900 is the pre on road.
But on the road, it's 66 something.
How many kilometers a year do you do, mate?
15,000.
Yeah, that's what I put. Okay.
Mine came from California. I don't know whether I was charged more stamp duty. It was quite big.
Yeah, there'll be a slight bit of extra stamp duty. It's a percentage. Yeah.
How long ago was that, Carmen?
1 year.
All right. Look at that.
30th of September 2020, to be exact.
Yeah, the price went up back around then, and Carmen was unlucky because the following week, the price dropped.
Yes.
And then again, and then again, and then again.
Yeah.
And I must admit, that's why we just bought ours now. We were looking at them and we were thinking about a Model Y, but kept hearing about all the prices going up in America. And I thought if they start creeping through, it could start jumping up. And there's still shortages of them at the moment. In fact, the waiting list has gone out to 3 months now. 2 to 3 months. So I thought, sorry, we'll get in early and see what we can do. But
and the Model Ys in China have sold out for the rest of the year as well, I heard today.
Oh.
Mm, so that doesn't bode well for Australia, the order book opening up in Australia anytime soon.
Yeah, I heard they were supposed to be opening the order book up roundabout now or early next year. But because both Texas and Berlin haven't come online anywhere near as quick as they thought they might. Everything's got pushed back, but they're supplying them all the Model Ys now over to Europe rather than us. That's what I heard.
Yeah, it probably is because there's better incentives.
So, Carmen, you're going to look
offering better incentives than our government offering.
Carmen, you're going to love this. I just looked it up again, and the value $59,900. Okay, for Standard Range Plus, and the quote is $765.
Oh, great.
Right.
Well, I look forward to a reply letter from the CEO.
Oh, hang on. Add hire car after accident. I'll do that.
Okay. Ooh. And
you've got to sort them out, Carmen.
That's jumped to 905. That's crazy. Because mine cost me $65 for my hire car.
Yeah, but you are 120, Richard. Don't forget that.
I'm 65 today, so watch it.
Yeah, that's dog years.
But what was the hire car? Was it an MG?
It was a Lotus Sports.
That's amazing. Anyway, so without the hire car, 765. Anyway, could do your own homework, but yeah.
Yeah.
Right, I'll have a plan. Thanks very much for looking at that.
Ripped off.
Yeah.
No, thanks for your help on that, Carmen. I've got an alternative there as well.
So speaking of car availability, there are basically 4 Model 3s left in Perth to buy this year. And they performance cars.
I just did a quick look on the normal one, just see what the pricing was. Look at the range, because I was looking at the range with that new range coming in, because I'd ordered mine and then the range changed. So I went into that, and when I looked at the little delivery date, they said 8 to 12 weeks.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. As soon as this interweb finishes, it's 8 to 12 weeks.
Yeah.
And you've got 491 kilometres in WLTP for the...
Yeah.
It doesn't cost that.
That's great. That's amazing.
Mine's going to be something different, I would think. I don't know what it'll be, because it's a funny one, because it's got the different motor but the lot of bigger batteries. So,
what's the performance?
6.1 seconds.
6.1 now.
Yeah.
Where the older one, which won't have that motor, so mine will be 5.6. So.
And I heard that silver is now included. It's a choice between white and silver for no extra cost.
Mm. Oh, yeah, it's called Poverty Plus. It's a new range. It's coming up.
Is that in Australia? Yeah. It wasn't on
No,
there
just
earlier.
US.
It's just in the US.
We just went for whiter than white.
Oh. Okay.
So speaking of waiting for cars and silver cars and stuff, Harold, do you have any news on when our Cybertrucks are showing up?
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks.
How long do you think all that'll take?
2 weeks. Really? Yeah, that's all.
Any idea when you're going to be finished here?
2 weeks.
How long will it take to put this place together?
2 weeks.
Hey, Mark, it's lovely to have you along. I know we'll never see you again after this.
Well, that was it. I thought it was a professional organisation, but you can't be right all the time.
No professional here, mate.
Speaking of 2 weeks, Todd and Gabby, if you don't speak up as newbies, you'll be waiting 2 weeks to say something.
That's right.
Yeah, Todd and Gabby.
Hang on, I'll turn the video on. We were here about 3 weeks ago. We're still trying to recover.
I recall you guys very well.
So does the 3 week wait, does it help, Eddie, or is it just the same when you come back?
It's exactly the same.
I've got something that's completely different. Let me just see if I can work out how to do this properly.
It's gold.
If it's the Dalek effect, we've had that one before.
This is a homage to Pete. A little bit like
the doghouse video.
No audio.
I thought it started and then it stopped.
No audio. Lost the audio.
Can you just sing My Sharona?
And we're still on a full screen.
Jared, speaking of audio, I believe there is some very good concerts coming to WA.
Yes, once the borders are open in 2027, they've got some shows coming through.
Jared, they're opening up in 2 weeks. Come on.
Not until Mark McGowan gets another tank dropped off at his house. And to be honest with you, I'm speaking to a lot of nurses lately. I've been a bit sick and I've been in hospital, and a lot of nurses are absolutely shitting themselves about the borders opening. because they fear the Walking Dead are going to come to the doors. And I got admitted 3 days ago into hospital for asthma, and I got treated like I had COVID. And I spent 9 hours in a little room with a window and watched the nurses get dressed in PPE, and they were teaching each other how to do it. There was like three at a time. It's quite funny actually, because they'd get through the door and then see me. And then just as I'd go back, I'd say, and they'd take their last gown off and go, oh, one more thing. And then they'd put their gown back on and come back in the door. So they quickly got to know that I was a pain in the ass and they wouldn't come back for a while. But until they COVID swabbed me, which by the way is the most horrible experience of your life. They did it, and then 4 hours later they tested to make sure they didn't have COVID. And then they went, then I turned into a normal patient. But they are absolutely frightened at the moment, the nurses, and they're not short of staff, but they just know what they're going to get. And the rumors that I've been hearing is like, once we open up, we're going to be going to lockdown for about 12 weeks. That's the story.
We just need to do what Singapore have done. If you get COVID and you haven't been vaccinated, the government aren't paying for your health care. You pay for it yourself, 100%.
Wow.
That'll stuff people up.
I'm with him.
Yeah, I'm with you on Nigel on that one.
Yeah.
Yep.
People need to wake up.
Me too.
Yeah, we're too complacent in Perth.
I think, but we're ruled by fear, though. I do have relatives all over Europe, and I don't hear any of these stories that you hear here.
People are still dying overseas.
Yeah. Sure.
Mm-hmm. They just don't advertise it. They don't talk about
it. Anti-vaxxers are using fear campaigns. I got asked today about the fact that some anti-vaxxers are saying that the Pfizer vaccine's got graphene oxide in it and it's poisonous, which is absolute bullshit because it doesn't been anywhere near graphene oxide.
Graphene is just pure carbon.
Yeah, precisely.
I know, but graphite oxide is actually can be toxic, but it's not. And it was because somebody in the University of Almeria in Spain did some transitional microscopic electron microscopic studies and said, oh, look, the structure of the Pfizer vaccine looks just like graphene oxide. So then the anti-vaxxers get a hold of it and go, it's made of graphene oxide, it's toxic, it'll kill you.
Fake news. Well,
I think that the hospitals here are going to be very busy with patients that are going to be very sick from COVID that didn't have any vaccinations.
Yeah.
Well, this is now a pandemic of the unvaccinated.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, some people are a bit basic, though.
There is a lot of concerts coming through. I can see a lot of them being postponed, and they won't come to Perth or they won't come to Australia. I'll wait and see, because I think a few things will change.
I'm hearing the same joke.
Yeah, well,
artists are not coming to Perth because they're worried about COVID.
Yeah, that's right.
Mm.
They're all still concerned about it. It's, you know, Qantas are pushing it like there's no tomorrow, opening everything up, doing what they can do. But it's still, you know, the people need to get vaccinated to get the numbers up to make that herd immunity work. And it's not seen to be happening in Perth at the moment, that's for sure. And another note, with that rapping star that managed to kill 8 people in America at a concert, that same Muppet was in Perth in 2018. And I actually had the pleasure of working near him. And he incited a riot at Joondalup Arena at the concert, or the Listen Out Festival that we were working on. And he was played over time and then got on the mic and told all the kids outside to rip the fence down and climb over the fence, which 600 of them started doing, and actually caused a riot at Joondalup. So him to sit back and say, oh, I didn't know people were dying, while I kept on singing and playing the song and kept the show going, was complete rubbish as far as I'm concerned. He incited so many things. And I was bored today and looked at a YouTube video of him in Mexico where he jumped into the crowd and a guy tried to steal his shoe off, and he's getting on the mic telling people to beat the guy up. And it's on a YouTube video. So I hope he goes to jail myself. I mean, it's a great thing that he's paying for 8 funerals, but that's nothing. They'll sue the hell out of him in America. you know, he'll be in Poverty Street in no time.
And in more Tesla news.
Yeah, there you go. He does know someone that drives a Tesla, though. So it's a part of the Tesla. So there you go.
I can tie them together. In more Tesla news, I'm taking my Tesla to Bridgetown next weekend. Quite looking forward to it.
That'd be nice. Bridgetown's a great spot.
Be a nice drive.
Yeah, they've got the Blue Festival on this weekend.
Oh, yeah, that's true. Yeah, that's right. Yep.
Yeah.
I wonder if you're going to meet anyone by perhaps this name.
Oh.
No.
Wrong screen, Harold.
Your desktop looks got like
OBS
mine,
there, Harold. He's working on some new technology and it's just getting there.
No, it's actually just no, it's not even that. It's just Skype. I'm not Skype, Zoom.
Zoom.
Just not picking the right screen. Okay, we'll try screen two. How's that? Does that look right?
That looks fine.
Yes.
Okay, and we'll see if we've even got sound.
No.
Not yet.
No.
No.
Nah.
Nobody's going to sing either.
You're not going to say that's Dr. Cooper playing the bass, is it? Something like that.
What?
Happy birthday too.
Thanks, Jared. You're not a well man, are you, really?
Yes. No,
I'm not as well as I normally am. Actually, right now, just so you know where I am, you can have a good look. There you go. I'm in a hospital room.
Oh, Jared, that's commitment, right?
So it's where I've been for the last 3 days.
Oh.
I've been educating the staff of not waking me up at 3 o'clock in the morning to test my blood. And they're sort of coming to the party that they're happy that I'm going home tomorrow morning, and so am I. So
wow.
There you go. And it was also Richard Malik's birthday today, Mandra, and he said that he was going to try and log on later on tonight, and maybe with some stripper girl, I think he said. Oh, I can't quite.
Oh, happy birthday, all the birthday boys.
Yeah, Richard, and yeah, that's amazing. Did you do anything special for your birthday?
I went and caught some carp.
That sounds, is that a code for when no, clubbing when, or something?
Birdsman's Lake, you catch big carp, you know, it's good fun. Fly fishing.
Inoculation afterwards?
No.
And then to the casino and wild
party? No, Sunday we're doing a big thing because it's my wife's birthday next week, so we do a big shindig on Sunday.
Okay, all nighter? Yeah.
No, too old for that shit, mate.
There you go.
So I hope you're doing what you're told, Jared, in hospital.
Oh, yes, I am. I'm definitely doing what I'm told.
I had my children had asthma and it was pretty awful. We had, in those days, we just had the Ventolin machines, but they used to burst blood vessels and cough up blood, and it was not easy.
It's worse now. This is probably the third time in my life I had to go to hospital because of it. But it's worse now when you roll up to emergency and you're sweating and coughing and you've got a sore throat and the first thing they think of is your COVID patient. And
I can imagine.
The first thing they did before they thought of anything else was they wanted to swipe me and then put me in that room. And they're like, no, then we'll deal with the rest of it. So it was really different. It was a really interesting experience.
I think you need to do a sign and flyer and say, I have asthma.
I showed him I was double vaccinated as well. They didn't care. They treated it. They're really on edge in the hospital. You can feel it.
Yes.
You know, speak to the nurses.
And rightly so, Jared. Absolutely.
Oh, 100%. 100%. I felt for every nurse I've had, I've been at great ones. Absolutely fantastic. Actually, the other morning I woke up and I had these two 18-year-old blonde trainees. It was like, I thought I was in some sort of movie. I was having a great day that day.
Was he nice?
The worst thing was, and this is a true story, I had one of my friends on the phone and I said, I've got to go. One of the nurses is here because she wants to check my pulse. And my mate, I'm a speaker, and he yells out, give her a smack on the ass for me. And she starts laughing. So they were fun times. But great people. The nursing staff at St John of God, absolutely fantastic, great people. And they're worried. They're definitely worried. It's just And you can see that fear, like, you know, like when I flew back from Sydney when COVID started, I flew back from Sydney and the Qantas hosties, you saw the fear on those faces and talking to them going, they've shuttled the A380s down and we're going to be out of a job next week and all that kind of stuff. It was the same sort of thing, you know, they were just, but the nurses, of course, were worried about, you know, so many people they're going to be dealing with.
Oh,
yes. Back, Harold.
He's got it. Harold. You there, Harold?
Yes, we heard him.
He's muted.
We can't hear you now, but we heard the sound from the music.
Technology has got the better of Harold now.
Okay. Harold, we're working on some top secret voice projects at the moment. So
let's just try this again. So I've got to do this and this, and then we'll try this.
There. Oh, yeah.
No.
That sounds.
It's going coming and going.
I think it might be a connection thing, maybe.
I think it's a problem between the keyboard and the chair.
We need to send somebody out to adjust the nut behind the keyboard. Sorry, Harold.
Darren and I were playing with this earlier and it worked so well.
It did. It was streaming very well. It's going great. It's been a good afternoon battle.
In the meantime, check your mobile. I sent you a text about Elon Musk.
Oh, Harold.
Oh, he's left Grimes again?
No.
They're back on.
I didn't quite get it.
He had a hard day, lost 28 billion. What is it? Something, how many? What was it?
24 billion, wasn't it?
200 billion is how much the market cap went down.
Oh, that's why you were crying. Is that why you were crying today?
Yeah.
Did you get a little tear going on?
Yeah.
So what did the share price now go to?
It's down. Just over it's down. It's
just
not
over 1,000 now.
Well, there we go. Yeah, it's up there already. The share price is up there. What a segue, hey? How quick was that? Look at that. There you go. Just over 1,000. Jeez, so we lost $300 somewhere.
Yep.
No wonder you're sad, Pete. I get it now.
Yeah, about
1023. Yep.
Jesus.
We're still 238 up for the month, so.
Yeah.
We're still doing fine.
But we're going to open just over $1,000, maybe 1,010, somewhere around there. 1,013, actually, is the indicative close at the moment. Indicative open, I mean.
So Todd, have you got your Tesla yet?
No, we're on the unicorn train. So we're due for the 28th of November. I think it's the first time we'll likely to see anything. I did want to ask you guys a couple of things. One, there's a guy in, I think, Wangara, who thinks he's the only guy that can put toe balls on the Tesla. Is that true? Or is there
that's Teddy Toeball, you mean?
Yeah, that must be him.
No,
you're, Rich, you're talking failing.
Toe balls on.
Richard Cooper, you're talking.
I did mine.
Yeah.
Richard Cooper does is everybody's. Todd, you might want to talk to Richard. If you take him some scones and jam, he'll probably throw it
in there. Marlboro is this poison.
Marlboro.
That reminds me. Ask you.
No.
You don't know me anything.
No, I do. No.
It's all good fun.
The Marlboro's in the mail.
Naughty.
But the Prime Minister of Australia, Rob, said on the radio, on the TV, they played it back, that electric vehicles can't tow a trailer or a boat. And
they can only tow aircraft, like the Model X, the Qantas are playing. So what the Model Y will be 1.6 ton, the Model 3 is 750 kilo, the Model X is 2.23 ton or something? that he can tow?
The Model 3 that I've got is good for
Mark, it's not normally this bad.
And the Cybertruck?
About six over six ton.
There you go.
6.5 ton or something.
The rating on the tow bar for my Model 3, I got a letter from the supplier of it just the other day. It's now up to a ton.
Yeah.
There you go.
That's the guy in Wangara, the Towlink tow bars guy. They fit it for me. It took him a while and it wasn't exactly cheap, but it works great. And you can pop it off and I just keep it in the boot. Most of the time, like, people don't even know I've got a tow bar.
How much, Shane?
Yeah, because it's that stealth one, isn't it?
That's the stealth one, yep.
What sort of price are those, Shane?
That was $2,800.
Installed all up, $2,800.
Installed, all done, yep.
That's good.
Yeah, the Model 3 is rated to tow 1,000 kilograms or 1 ton.
The little stick, they sent me a new set of stickers because when I bought it, it was only good for 750 and I think 250 on the ball. And now it's a ton and I can't remember what it is on the ball now. But they upped the rating on it.
So it works great.
Even fully loaded trailer, I'll still beat most people off the lights.
But why is that change? Why is that change? Is it because of the car or the tow bar?
I think they had the tow bar retested.
Right. Okay.
And lifted it up.
That's good to know. I've been waiting for months because Tesla's supposed to come out. Well, they've got their own tow bar in other markets, but when the Model Y comes out, presumably, because in the UK, when you order a Model Y, it says that you can order a tow bar after the fact, so post-purchase, you can order one through Tesla, and it's expected to be only about $1,200-$1,300 fitted, and that'll be a factory one, but I don't know if they'll be able to tow 1,000 kilos, probably only be 750, that one.
Yeah, I believe that the Model Ys in other markets actually have a removable plastic bit at the back. You know how underneath the back of the boot it's got like a plastic cover there. I believe in a lot of markets there's actually a removable plastic bit there. Our ones don't have that, and they actually have to cut a hole through a little bit of plastic to get access up underneath.
No, they don't. Mine doesn't. Mine's got a removable access.
Mine, he had to actually cut it out.
What year's yours?
Mine. Yeah. Is this year 6 months old?
Oh, okay.
There you go.
Yeah. So maybe the Chinese ones are different to the.
Shane was the same as mine.
I believe they are. Yeah, mine's the Chinese
one.
And mine's the same as Shane's.
So you don't have the access cover.
No.
They cut that out, and then there's a couple of plates that bolt into the back of the secret trunk, and they undo those, and that's where your tow bar actually mounts to.
I did mine. It's fun taking the rear bumper off, but it's all doable.
I got a question. DJ Harold.
Harold's still trying to make music work. I think the joke's like past. I forget why we were trying to watch it now.
It was about 2 weeks ago we were waiting for that.
I can tell you how it ends.
I've got a question for Rob, our president. What is your opinion, Rob, of what the federal government announced today on EV?
I heard Rob's comments on the radio about that. That was well done, mate. Well,
I actually didn't hear anything. What did you say, Rob?
I said it was a kick in the guts for country people because putting 50,000 chargers into people's homes is the dumbest idea ever.
Yeah.
We need chargers between towns so people can drive from one place to the other.
Yeah.
Anyone's got a 10-amp power point at home.
Yeah.
I agree. Unless you're in an apartment building where you can't, where you're parking, there's no charging in the car park. apart from the apartments, I completely agree.
Yeah, but the government, there's plenty of other ways the government can make that happen in an apartment building. Plenty.
Exactly. Yeah. There's only two reasons that are really stopping people from really adopting EVs. If anyone's sitting on the fence, it's either because of the upfront cost or the fact that they don't believe the infrastructure is developed enough where they can go on a long road trip and be able to charge everywhere. So like Rob said, you need the chargers in the country and you need the stamp duty to go.
Pete, it still doesn't explain. Most couples nowadays have two cars. So why couldn't they have one Tesla and one other if they're nervous about the infrastructure?
Because of the upfront cost. So there's two reasons. Yeah, it's the infrastructure and the upfront cost. So it's the upfront. You know, in New South Wales, they dropped the stamp duty. Victoria's got a $3,000 incentive to try and level the playing field because we're subsidising fossil fuels and taxing EVs.
I hear you, Pete.
we've got to start.
I think it's charging
stamp duty on electric cars?
Yeah, but even so, I think people just don't understand it. There's not enough facts. There should be a fact sheet that explains the basics of owning an EV. And because some people ask very silly questions, really, and it's because they don't understand it. And the RAC doesn't, the girls that sell it don't understand it either. So we need to put something out there.
We need to put something in place to the RAC regarding EV cars and working at a better price with EV cars and pushing it.
Just a fact sheet and send it to all the radio stations and TV stations. And then they will know because most people don't know enough about it. It's got to come from an authority. I'm happy to do it, but nobody will take any notice of me.
Oh, that's not true, Carmen.
Unless I sign Elon Musk.
That's not true, Carmen. The federal police are taking notice.
Actually, they're not. I'm trying to get some notice from them on another matter, and they're ignoring.
Not with that insurance company they got. They're not. They found the CEO today for the company. Let's see. Your CEO for the insurance company. They found him today. Back in the container.
You're just wicked, Jared. That's what it is. They've been very nice. They send me notes.
Oh, there you go.
Let me see.
And Barry, it was your birthday the other day, wasn't it? Barry, was it your birthday?
Yeah, it was. Sorry, I come off mute. Yeah, it was.
Yeah, happy birthday. Yeah.
Thanks, Jared.
And you sport yourself with a little present?
Several.
Oh, yeah, one that we can talk about, not that other Russian one that you got.
that's between me and Carmen.
Hey, did you know?
I got the yoke steering wheel, got that on. I've got the...
That's bloody Richard Cooper. Richard Cooper... has made 20 Tesla owners buy yokes.
Yeah,
has yours, Harold?
And he's stolen one of my installs. I had it teed up to put one in for someone else, and Richard came in and with a better offer.
He's good like that. He's the smarter man.
Jared, did you know that Budget Direct has won the insurance a prize for best insurer 2017, 18,
19, 20,
and
21. Yeah. Putin think they're fantastic. He thinks they're great. They're doing good business. So, they're going well. They're going very well.
Yeah.
There you go.
I'm trying to catch up with Richard. So I got the yoke. I got the front kit yesterday. I got the light kit for the front. And I don't think he's got the tail lights that I've got.
No.
Give it an hour, Barry.
And I've got the Raspberry Pi USB drive that automatically uploads all the video footage to the to my NAS drive. When I get home, as soon as I get home, it connects to the network, uploads all the video footage. And if I've got any music, it automatically downloads it. So really cool little modification, that one.
There you go. Yes, Richard Cooper's got a lot of talented skill sets in...
got catching up to do.
Sorry?
I've got catching up to do, it seems.
Well, you know...
Oh, yeah.
I think Barry's just throwing down a bit of a gauntlet at you, Richard. So
yeah.
You, you might have to look
at some of your job, I think.
I do know that 20-odd families are going poor this Christmas because the owners of the car had to buy a yoke, including
Harold,
our secretary. And it's just
Harold, how's your mate?
I'm trying.
How's your yoke, Harold?
Yeah, it's good. And that's no good.
I've got a funny feeling that Pete's going to be next. I'll give it another 2 weeks. I reckon Pete will definitely be in. You're muted, Pete. But I reckon you're...
Yeah, 2 weeks, yeah.
Can't hear you, Pete. Pete, you're muted. No sound.
Hey, Barry, have you got a picture of your yoke installed to show everyone? They may not know what you're talking about.
What were you saying, Pete?
Yeah, hang on. I'll try and find it and do a Harold.
I'll wait for Barry, but I was just going to ask Harold if he could just take it off record for a second. I wanted to ask a question, but I'll wait for Barry. Actually, yeah, probably right. Take it off record while Barry looks for it.
Okay, hang on. Oh, no, he's got it.
Oh, no, there's Barry now.
There we go. It's nice.
That's very nice.
Can you see it okay?
Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah.
All I can see is the koala.
Now I can see something else.
Koala?
No, we've got somebody's thing up.
Harold,
you got your thing up.
Let's go our email again. Harold?
Yeah.
Not me. It's not me. Yeah.
Oh, it's not you? Okay.
Hang on. Did I share? Have I heard of Harold and shared the wrong thing?
Oh, it was a Russian.
No, for a minute there, we could see all your emails, Barry.
Oh, okay. It should be.
Now you had it up.
This one's mine.
Yeah.
You get an unobstructed view of the binnacle, which is a bonus. And notice, Jared, that I'm on.
Nadia.
Noted.
Nadia.
What is the legality of these yokes in this state or country at the moment?
Well, according to social welfare, the Costco Christmas packages that will be going out this year instead of decent presents because of all these people buying yokes, it's not a good sign, apparently. So.
How legal are they?
I don't know. They still retain the same airbag in the same position. So I guess it'll have to be a question for I don't know.
I don't think they'd say anything. They'll just go, it's a Tesla. Yeah, that's it.
That's right.
You know, if you go and buy one with a yoke in, now it comes across, that's it. It's done.
And that's no yoke.
That's no yoke. So, Pete, answer my question. How long? 2 weeks?
Oh, so Pete was going to go off record. So, this is.
It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter how.
Oh, okay. That's cool. Because I was going to try and bash out this stupid track. But anyway, it's just not going to work. Jared, I can't believe it worked for us so many times. Could you hear it? Yes, it was all good. Awesome.
Yeah.
You'll never make a DJ, Harold, so look for another job.
you can still hear this, can't you?
How long do you think all that'll take?
2 weeks.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That's good.
That's actually just replaced you.
Yes, that's right.
It should be the full screen.
To go full screen, I have to spotlight myself. And then unfortunately for you guys, it then usually keeps me on there until you go back to
yes,
matrix mode or whatever it's called, which is a bit of a pain. But
we're going to work on that.
YouTube, for everyone in YouTube.
I noticed when you play it, there's like a fade or something.
Yeah, it fades out and then comes back in. And
yeah, it almost
sounds as if there's a noise gate or something that's chipping in to try and stop noise.
Yeah. Yes. And it's something I was working on for the last, 2 days. I was up until about 2 in the morning this morning.
Oh,
trying to get it going. The video stuff's easy. It's the audio that just does your head in, especially when you have virtual cables and stuff. It's just...
Well, couldn't you tape it separately as a video and play it from a video?
Next week.
I did try that because basically I did do a screen share and we could try it again one last time. And we'll do screen 2. That's not going to work.
Pete?
Yo.
Any news on the yoke? What's going on with the yoke?
Uh-huh.
Pete?
Yeah, he doesn't need to do the yoke. He's got oh, I drove Chris Lim's car, which was a Samsung Plus. It was great. Loved it. But I said, what's wrong with your screen, mate? Because it was pointing straight, and I've driven my tilted screen for so long that I thought there was actually something wrong with his screen, and now he's decided to get a tilting screen.
Hey, Richard, you are so right. When you were saying that, I thought, yeah, he's exaggerating a little bit. And then I drove the Lexus, which obviously has the
flat screen,
the center console or whatever you call it, flat. And I'm like, oh my God, this is exactly what Richard was talking about. It actually feels like it's
pointing the other way,
pointing away from you. Yeah. And then I was in the vault and same thing. And then I got back into the Tesla and went straight back in. And because it was actually the other way because my son was playing games on it. And all I right. pulled it back towards me and went, I'm at home.
Hey, Barry, can I share my screen? I want to show you something. Desktop photos, that's one. So it does look nice when it's pointing at you.
Yeah.
And you've got a different, my yoke's a slightly different shape to yours. More square at the bottom.
Hey, Rich.
Yep.
I'm looking at your screen.
Yep.
Yeah. Above the yoke.
Yep.
That looks really good too.
Yeah.
I've seen a couple of people with them.
Yeah, it's good in that you can actually see the indicators because the indicators are really quiet. Well, they go there and they're quite bright and it's got a few features I like. The trouble with the air conditioning is it blocks the air conditioning a bit, but I figured if I point it straight up, and then when Harold finished, and then point it straight up and then pull my sun visor down, I can direct it to the top of my head, my face, with the sun visor. It's brilliant.
Oh, there you go.
So it's been out, but it works.
And Richard, was it hard to do?
Sorry, what?
Was it hard to do?
This one?
The screen? Yes.
One. The screen's pretty easy, but trying to put the cables together under the glove box is a bit of a trauma. But yeah, it's not too hard. So
you just I reckon the coolest thing about that, Richard, is how you can bring up the front camera on that.
Oh yeah, I installed the front camera. It's brilliant. When you park, it automatically turns on. When you go close to something, your front camera comes on. It's brilliant.
That's a good idea.
Yeah,
it's a good idea.
And be very handy if you had a four wheel drive as well.
So, anyway, I'll get rid of that.
Yeah, it looks very cool.
Don't know what I've done there.
Very cool.
We should mention Harold. We've got a event coming up in 2 weeks. It's on Tuesday, the 23rd.
2 weeks? 2 weeks?
2 weeks?
It's less than 2 weeks.
13 days.
13 days.
That's it.
13 days.
No time to die.
That's it.
So the new James Bond movie, Harold's going to bring it up in a second. I can tell, I can see the cogs moving.
We've got 27 cars going already. So that's some good news.
Wow. That's more than we had last year.
I haven't even registered mine yet, but I'll be going.
I'm going to try and go.
Oh, you can go.
What time is the start? Does anyone know? Early.
So we've negotiated access 45 minutes early. So they open the gates at 6:15, but Tokwa gets access at 5:30, so we can get set up.
You've got
get all the good spots.
You've got 5:15 on there.
Yeah, we've got 5:15.
That's good.
That's all right. 5:15 is actually a good time, so we can all get ready to go in at 5:30.
Yep.
I might be a bit late. That's all.
That's all right.
That's okay. You can get there. I don't think the movie starts till about 7:15 or 7:30 from memory.
Okay.
Obviously the idea is to get there early so that because it will be a popular movie, considering it would have just released. So, want to get there early to get the good spots.
How's the
sound? And that way we can all. Yeah, that's good. I'll save your spot, Alex.
All right, save your spot.
How do you listen to the sound these days?
Yeah.
Oh, you put that box in the window.
Turn it off. No, seriously, how do you do it these days?
Through the FM radio.
Right.
Yeah, and Richard, it's not a threepence to go there, right? It's
not threepence.
No, it's not a threepence.
That's a two-score-and-two-pence.
Killings these days, mate.
And it's colour as well. It's not black and white.
Okay. What's colour?
Colour. It's got sound as well.
Oh, my God. And you leave with the five. Can you record it on your five track?
And Richard. Eight track. Richard, it's as many people as you want in the car. You don't have to put them in the boot anymore.
And you can put one in the. I can put one of my grandkids in the front. I don't have any grandkids yet, but if I
put one in the front and two in the.
And I can just sit there and just press on the dash, and the front will open, and they can watch the movie. I won't be able to, but they can.
Gold, absolutely gold. Yeah, I wouldn't miss it. I think it'd be great.
And they'll have waitresses and rollerblades bringing you milkshakes and popcorn.
And roller skates, mate. You're showing your age. You're too young.
Roller skates. Sorry. Only kidding.
Are you going, Carmen? Who's everyone going?
You're going to finish here?
Possibly.
Yeah, it's a Tuesday night.
You're not winning, Harold. You're just not winning, mate.
Richard, are you going to be down? Richard Chapman? Are you going to be? You going? Good. How's the wife, by the way? I saw she had a bit of a, I can see you've been doing all the housework. Yes, good boy. Yeah, good boy.
Hey, Jared, I sent you a private message, a chat, if you want to have a look at it.
Okay, definitely.
I'm going to put this on pause for just a moment.
There you go.
And we're back. A big shout out to Damon, Joseph, Ashley, and others who missed it. It was a very hilarious discussion of these short shorts. So, Pete, I'm looking forward to seeing those sometime soon. But, Damon, Joseph, Ashley, unfortunately, just missed out on that.
Believe that, you'll believe anything.
Actually, I think Russell, in his absence, could be a great candidate for those short shorts.
Where is Russell?
Oh, yeah.
Well, Russell's otherwise occupied. Welcome back, Jane, or welcome, Jane. Oh, you're muted, sorry.
You're muted, Jane, darling. Hello.
Hello. Hi, I've just popped in. We've just ordered a Tesla 3 and I'm terrified, but I thought I'd be sitting on this and
No need to be terrified.
Congratulations.
Except for Jared, be terrified.
Thanks, Shane.
Congratulations.
So when are you getting your car, do you know?
No, I don't know. Up to 12 weeks, like I guess everyone's been told at the moment. Yeah.
Welcome to the slowest 12 weeks of your life.
Well, I'm kind of used to range anxiety because I've got a dedicated gas old Ford, and I'm finding it really hard to find anywhere to fill it up. So every time I head for my nearest station that still has auto gas, I usually find it's gone. And country trips have become really difficult. So I think driving an EV is going to be like that in reverse, where they'll be coming, there'll be more and more places you can top up instead of the other way around.
Where do you live?
So I'm in Leeming in Perth, but okay. I drive down to Denmark fairly often and past York quite often.
Well, Richard Chapman just drove up to Port Hedland, or Broome actually, didn't you, Richard? All the way up in his EV, everywhere. Had no problems at all.
Good.
He does have a very long extension lead, though, but he no problems whatsoever, really.
Yeah, so bring up plug share, but there you go.
Jane, you'll get down to Denmark very easily.
Yeah, so you can just go to the supercharger at Williams.
We usually stop there anyway. So, I know there's one in Kojunup, well, there's top up in Kojunup.
There's a fast DC charger in Kojunup as well. So you can also, and it's right near the, there's a
this is a center. Cafe, yeah.
Center. Yeah. So you can certainly do a opportunistic top up there as well. And in which case you'll get to Denmark with no worries at all.
Yeah, so when you're in Denmark, there's good places to keep topped up, are there?
There's only one place, which is the Chimes Spa Resort, but what you can do is just in the back of your car, you'll have a what's called the UMC, which is the Universal Mobile Connector, and it has a 10 and 15 amp tail. So the 10 amp tail looks like this, and at the other end just plugs into your UMC, your mobile connector, and with that you'll get about 120 kilometres of range overnight, so while you're sleeping. So if you're in Denmark for a couple of days, or even just a day, your car will get a couple hundred Ks of added range while it's just resting in your carport.
Good, yeah.
And one of our members actually lives in Denmark. She's got a wide standard range plus Angela.
Okay. Yep. Absolutely. So, I mean, how long do you normally go to Denmark? You do regular trips to Denmark or just?
Probably about four times a year. So it's not that often, but I usually stay about four nights with my sisters and we go walking on the trails.
Perfect. Yep.
Yeah. But. Sorry. Sure. Well, we also do quite a lot of running around with kayak on the roof, so I'm going to get some roof racks, and I know that will probably cut the distance out. So
a little bit, but not hugely. I mean, what sort of side trips? You do 50 kilometres each way? I mean, even to Albany is about 60 kilometres, I think.
Probably about that far, not hugely far, yeah, over towards Walpole and back quite a bit.
Yeah, cool. It's easy because when your car is back at your sister's place or wherever, when you just plug it in, like I said, it basically adds about 10 to 12 kilometres of range per hour. So in 10 hours, there's 120 k's. 24 hours is 240, and anything longer than that, and basically your car's full regardless. So there really is no issue with range. And like you said, with the LPG, I used to have a dedicated LPG car. And yeah, I mean, if there's no LPG, there is no alternative. There's nothing else. They're not dual.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you're right, that we're just continuing to delete them. And the price went up hugely. I think it's well over $1 a litre for LPG. So Your EVs, your Model 3 is going to be an awesome experience.
And Jane, what actually got you to the crossed you over the line to actually take the plunge and buy an EV?
I've been wanting one for ages, but yeah, it's only just because we can now afford it. But yeah, I've been promoting them for ages without actually having one. Yeah, because
and exactly the same as I was. I got mine on the 6th of September. It's the only car birthday I've ever known.
I can't
forget mine because mine came out of the factory on my actual birthday. It's always meant to be.
Oh, that's good.
Good one.
Yeah, my wife wanted a Tesla for years, and I'll never forget a look on her face when I said we're getting one, and then she found out it was a battery, a Powerwall. emotion. Broke down in tears. It was quite a special moment. But yeah,
she wanted another one too, Joe, didn't she?
She ended up getting three, and she could sit in it really comfortable on top of all three because when they strap together, there's a bit more room. then we finally bought the car, and I tell you, I was pretty not hesitant, but I was very concerned when we first bought it. But she wasn't, but I was. And I tell you, it's the best decision I've made in my life about any car. I've driven a lot of cars in my time. I've driven all kinds of different cars and hired cars, and I love the car. I feel, the only thing that it's just learning every time. I learn more and more things about the car all the time. It's not stop learning.
Sounds pretty scary. Sounds like it's going to be quite different. I haven't driven one yet.
You'll have one regret.
It's just exciting. It's just, it's not the same. It's like the same button that you buy from Toyota. When you buy a Toyota, the button that says this is there and it's there for the rest of the life of the car. With the Tesla, it might not be there. It might be something else, or it might be upgraded. It might be a different color. That makes it more exciting and more interesting. And all the features that we've got that I don't see in half the cars this day and age. Yeah. And also the fact that you're not paying $2 a litre for fuel.
Yeah, I'm just terrified of the road tax when they bring one of those in with the mileage. That'd be awful. Yeah.
WA's never really followed the eastern states in that regard. You look at things like, we don't pay tolls. There's no toll road in WA yet.
Yeah.
We always get threatened with it, but it never arrives. It's the same as daylight savings. I think the I don't think it'll be an EV tax as such. I think it might be maybe an addition to your your rego, but I don't think it's going to be a big deal, and I think that is because the electricity, we pay for electricity regardless.
Might be a new government. That'd be good.
New government.
Mark McGowan has said categorically a couple of times publicly that they've got no intentions of following Victoria's lead.
Yeah, it was a really interesting thing where you see Victoria bring out EV incentives and then 6 months later bring out a tax on EVs per kilometre. And you're like, that's a bit cheeky.
Just do one or the other.
Yeah. Oh, I've got a really trivial question. Like, really trivial question. I've got to get a number plate. And I've just looked at the online, the government site for it, and there's acrylic or aluminium. And what sort of shape?
Acrylic's good. I've got acrylic.
The acrylic is a little bit lighter and... less likely to get scratched, etc. But in terms of the shape, so you can get the slimline for the front or the back, but if you go slimline, the WA goes on the side. So depending on what word you and if you actually go on that website and you toggle between the two, it shows you a rendering of what it will look like.
Yeah.
And you'll be able to see the WA on the side. As opposed to the top,
right? I wasn't quite sure which shape number plate was right for it, but I guess
they're all work. They're all fine.
The slim so one looks
just,
nice.
Just comes down to personal
choice. There you go. Ants shared something.
Can I just put a word in for platinum plates? I went and changed mine for platinum plates. They don't cost as much as the custom plates, acrylic or aluminium. They cost 140 to change them out with the old WA plates. But as you can see, it fits the Model 3 really nicely, I thought.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm.
Yeah. Did you go stand on the front there, Ant? The front and the back, you go the same or different?
Yeah, they're the same on both front and back. I'm denied about that because some people think that because the back is larger, the normal plate size, but in black, or in platinum like that would suit well. But I think slimline back and front looks fine. I'll put the back up now.
Okay.
Isn't that your wife's car, Ant?
Yes, it is. And I might just add there, because you're going to be a new owner, Catherine she really, really likes the car now, but she didn't drive it for a few weeks initially. A little bit of trepidation there, but now difficult to get her out of it. I mean, occasionally I beg her to, if I can have a drive, and she lets me.
If you would like to have a drive, you're welcome to drive mine. We can meet, sure. And have a test.
Until I tell you where I work, and then.
Oh, yeah. Carmen, I can smell a bit of RAC in the room.
I was talking to Janet.
So that's the slimline acrylic front and back. You can see a little bit there.
Yeah,
right. I found it amusing. I was at the WA Swim Centre in Joondalup, and I had another Tesla right next to me. I was like, this doesn't happen often.
That's okay. Cool. Well, that's good, Jaffa. That's good.
Thanks for the offer. I'm really scared about driving someone else's car.
No, we can do it in a car park or in a non-busy area. Don't worry. Yeah,
just,
don't worry.
You know, because I haven't tried driving one yet, and I just think, oh,
it's no problem. It's the same as driving a normal car.
It's right. Carmen's insured.
Yeah, I'm insured with the Russians.
But if you're worried about that, you can ring the dealership, or you can just walk, give them a call and arrange a test drive, and they'll let you test drive the car for an hour without a salesman being next to you. So you can take the car out yourself for an hour and test it out and bring it back.
My advice is to take up Carmen's offer for example, because you get someone with you who knows the car. Yeah. When I first drove a Tesla and the dealer just let me take the car, I knew a couple of functions that I'd learned along the way, but everything else I was a blind bat. So I think having someone else who's got one and can walk you through some of the features is really good.
And we can do it somewhere like Kings Park or one of the parks that is large, and you don't have to manage the road traffic until you're comfortable or on a Sunday too.
Thanks.
Or what you could do is you could meet Carmen in Osborne Park, and the two of you could take the Tesla car if you're worried about driving someone else's car, and then the two of you could take the Osborne Park.
Jane, don't feel bad about asking any questions here in this group, because this is the place that you want to ask those stupid questions, not ask the dealer.
Yeah, I do feel embarrassed about some of my questions.
When I rang the dealer and I asked him that one of the reversing lights on our performance didn't work, and then he said to me that you only get one reversing light, and he said, by the way, you're the fourth guy to ring me today, you idiot.
Yes, well,
we've got lots of stupid answers for stupid questions.
And that's why it's more acceptable here than at the dealership, but, you know.
Well, the thing is that we all ask these questions because we all were novices at some point, so we were all in your shoes, you know, so... Yeah. So there is no such thing as a silly question.
Exactly.
Yeah. Speak for yourself, Pete. I always thought you were ahead of the curve.
Jane, I've got something to add for you too. So I'm jumping in here. Jane, I've got something for you. You're going to have one regret, and that's not getting your Tesla sooner.
Yes.
That's a standard regret, Jane. Don't worry about it.
Although, just questioning, if she's getting likely a December or January delivery, are you getting the SR or the long range, Jane?
Oh, no, unfortunately, I wasn't able to push my husband to the long range, so I'm just getting the standard.
Oh, that's all right. Does that mean she's getting the extra little bit of kilometres that I've heard that are going into the new ones?
I've heard something about a tiny bit more. Is it about 40Ks more or something? I'm not quite sure.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. You get the longer range.
Right.
Yeah, I think the build date's the end of October, so, yeah, you'll get the extra.
But is it apparently the car... When you like the 0 to 100 is now 5.8 instead of 5.5.
It's 6.1.
It's
6.1.
All right. Okay.
Can you still pay the $3,000 and get the acceleration boost?
You still lose your license very quickly though. You still lose your license in 7 seconds. So there's no problem.
Actually, on that acceleration boost question, was that only available for the long range? I thought it was only available on the long range versions.
Yeah, it was only for the long range.
To get you from 4.4 to 3.9 seconds.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. That's a shame.
Tell John he's stingy, not trumping up the money for the extra long range.
Well, the thing is that if you're really worried about the range, and if you couldn't care less about how fast it is, it will be fast enough, trust me. But I charge my car only to 80%, and you can charge it to 90% on a daily basis without a problem. But with the long range, if you charge that to 80%, and the standard range, which you're actually advised to charge to 100% at least once a week, so that one's fine to charge to 100% every day, you'll get the exact same range. It's identical. So the 80% of the long range is exactly the standard range, the range of the standard range plus. Right. So if you charge to 90%, you'll get, 10% more.
And should I order one of those wall chargers straight away? Because I think they're out of stock or something, aren't they?
They're just coming back to stock today.
They're back now, yeah.
Because I had a look and then I thought that must be the American site or something because I was sort of dipping in and out of the website.
Have you got a three-phase house, Jane? Has she got three-phase power?
I don't know. I find the techno stuff really
easy. If you take two photos, if you can take a photo of the whole of the inside of your meter box and then another photo of a close up of just your meter, and if you can either text it to me or just put it up on next week or whenever, put it up on the screen, I'll be able to tell you straight away if you're single.
Don't order that until you know that.
And Jane, you don't need the good news is you don't need to do anything urgently. Like even when you can just wait for your car to arrive, you can just enjoy it. You can literally just plug it into a 10-amp outlet in your garage or carport or whatever. And average people drive about 40 kilometres. The average West Australian drives 40 kilometres per day. Even using the slowest form of charging, that will get done in about 3.5 hours.
Okay. I was talking over. I just want to give a shout out to Nigel because I just realised, Nigel, it's you.
Thank you, Jane. I mentioned John gave it away, wasn't it?
I don't know, with you sitting with that Hertz car background and everything, I was sort of a bit confused. I just want you to know, Nigel, that John's handed in his Fiat plates from his little blue Fiat that he loves. So he no longer has, he now has a spare set of Fiasco plates. But I don't think I should put it on the Tesla.
No.
Why not? He's got rid of his little Fiat 500.
No, his Punto.
Oh, his Punto. All right.
Yeah, he's still got the Abarth. But no, he's...
His Punto had an issue with a part that was going to take a very long time to get. And then it was going to cost more than the car was worth with the mileage on it, etc. So he sold it to the wrecker for $500.
But he's still got the Abarth.
Yes, yeah.
Isn't that the acronym of Fiat, which is Fixed Again, Tony?
Well, it was because I read Martin Amis's book, Money, and he made a joke about Fiats and called them Fiasco. And it travelled from that.
Well, you might have to go or Tesla.
Sorry, what is that?
You've made the right choice to go all in on Tesla.
Well, actually, John was trying to get the Hyundai, the new one. You know that
EV6.
Ioniq.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But he joined in that online, you know, that call you had to get on and try and nominate for it. And
yeah, that was a fiasco.
Yes, there are about, I think there are about 240 cars and about 10,000 people trying to get them.
And but only about 40 in WA. No, sorry, 18 in WA.
Wow. Yeah. Anyway, I wanted a Tesla all the way, but John wanted the Hyundai.
You always were the more sensible girl, Jane.
But then he gave in because he thought he'd never get his electric car not for a long time. He realised the Teslas are more likely to be available sooner.
The Hyundais were, there were only four allocated to WA and the rest were demos. A mate of mine, managed to get them. Yeah.
You did?
No, a mate of mine managed to get the Ioniq 5, but only after being refused his first choice. But can I just put a word in here? Because I recently, a friend of mine said that their wife had chatted to a tall, handsome bloke at Dowerin on Sunday, and his wife has now put in an order for a Tesla LR, Model 3 LR, which will arrive in March. Apparently, that's what the deliveries for the LRs are. And I'm also chatting to a chap today who was wavering about the Model S that he saw at Westside Autos, and he's bought that today. So that's two new Teslas. I told him to pop up in this group. I don't know if he is there. Paul, are you there? Oh, sorry. Paul Damien, I think his name is.
Not here.
No. Not here.
Did many of you go to Darwin?
66.
Yeah, well, there were 60.
Yeah. Wow.
It was a good number there. It was a great day.
Mm. And did you have the effect you wanted on the that bloke with the service station?
Yeah. Yeah, 65 people are banned from the town now. They'll never land back. That's worked well. Gone great.
Well, even the coppers took a drive, and I think it was James's car that they took for a drive. It outpaced the pace car, the police pace car. Oh, so, wow.
You don't mean they were doing drags down the street, were they?
They sort of were.
Oh, with the sirens on and everything.
Yeah.
Allegedly.
By the way, did I say that the tall, handsome bloke who basically sold the car must have been Pete Petrovsky? He's the only tall, handsome bloke I know in this group.
Jeez, it must be between
few of us around. Okay.
Oh my God.
By the way, since it was a great shout out for Pete, I've actually worked out what all my audio problems were all along, much to my embarrassment. So I think I'm going to give this thing one last try, and this time
it's going to work. You go yep, right,
you've
brother.
Got 8 minutes.
Yeah, it's going to work. So we're going to go straight to this for Pete.
Hey, there we go.
Yes.
Better need the picture now.
Gonna go.
it is with Pete and scaring the ladies and chiming them, but yeah,
that's another 2 weeks.
Energy I drive as well.
Timing that, Harold, that was good.
They're going to change view to go back to gallery.
Yes, go back to gallery. Sorry, because you got me. But for YouTube, they all have gallery. Yeah, apologies for those people who play with Zoom. You play with audio cables and stuff. There's a little setting called original sound, and you've got to turn that on. Because if you don't, it tries to get rid of anything that's not words, spoken language, and that includes songs. So that was the whole problem all evening, was one little tiny setting. Jared, it was working the whole time. That's why I was coming in and out as he was singing. There you go. Yeah.
That's what
we're well done for working that out.
Good work, Harold. We're going to get there and see that.
Get there eventually. But, big shout out for Pete. I believe, Pete, you're also responsible, or Jürgen, actually, for similar reactions to a lot of the Synergy people at iDrive.
Oh, yeah.
In fact, I think Sandra doesn't mind saying that she felt quite nauseous at the end of the process for quite a while. Which is
they were warned. They said, you know, that it was the last drive of the day after 250 drives, and two of the girls drove the car, and the third lady was going to have a go, and she said, no, this is the last go. I'd rather be a passenger and see how quickly you can go. So it was self-inflicted.
It's all good. I mean, it's a good cause, and you know, there's no doubt that their next car is going to be an EV.
And yeah, they did mention that actually. And we got it all on video too, but I have to speak to Sandra and get her permission first before we play it.
Yeah. Has she bought one?
Not yet, but all three of them said that the next car will definitely be an EV, most likely a Tesla. It's only two things. It's charges and upfront cost. So those are the only two things, public charges and upfront cost. Only two things that hold people back.
But they don't do the breakdown of, how much you're going to pay on fuel and servicing.
They think about the now rather than the later.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, and, I explained all that. You have a guess, guys. How much do you reckon? So obviously we know that Tesla doesn't have a service schedule. But if you were to follow their recommendations and service the car or do whatever they recommend in the manual, how much do you think you'd spend on servicing on a Model 3 over a five-year period? To give you a hint, the average car is supposed to be serviced every 10,000 K or every 6 months, and the average service for an average car in Australia costs $267. So about $2,670 over a five-year period for an average car.
Well, mine used to cost $2,000 a year.
And that's not including tyres.
That's not including tyres or wheels, yeah.
That's right.
I'd say about a third of that, a third.
So
I know that a third because Hyundai charge about a third the Kona.
Okay.
No, it's less than
that. I'd say
200.
280. Okay, so Nigel's at 200. Any other guesses?
280.
280 at Richard. Any more bids?
Well, I didn't spend any for the first year.
I'll go 100. I reckon it's about $100 because I think the only thing you've got to change is the brake fluid, isn't it?
You've got to put water in the windscreen wiper.
Carmen uses
Evian. Carmen doesn't. Evian. So that's $3.
Jared, is it tap water?
No way. I didn't put tap water.
I did.
The distilled or demineralized water?
demineralized.
Oh, is it?
Yeah, not tap water. Okay. No.
Yeah, tap water will leave streaks on your windscreen. You don't want that.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll change. I'll add some more.
But
what's the answer?
$222. So Nigel was the closest. $222, because there's really only two things according to the manual. There's a third thing, but that's only if you're in a cold climate where there's salt put on roads because of snow. So you, as Shane said, you've got to check the brake fluid for contaminants, which Richard showed us last week or the week before, which you can do with a $5 pen. But if you get Tesla to do it, they'll charge you a whopping $24. And then the only other thing to do is every 2 years to swap out the pollen filter. That's it's 56 odd. It works out to $87 for supply and install if you get Tesla to do it. And you got to do, you'll do that twice over a 5 year period. So it all adds up to $222 over 5 years.
When do you have to look at coolant and the transmission oil? How many years is that?
Transmission?
Yeah, there's oil in the
What transmission?
Well, it's got an oil filter. Well, it's got a transmission.
It's an electric motor.
It's got a reduction gear, and it's got an oil pump and an oil filter on it and all sorts of stuff.
It doesn't need changing, as I understand it.
Nothing in the manual. Nothing in the manual about it.
I think it's about 6 years, they say, look at it. So.
Well, transmissions are usually sealed for decades, so I had a
right. There's nothing under the maintenance check section.
Right.
To be fair, around five or 6 years, you might have to swap out the 12-volt battery. But as far as what's recommended under the maintenance section, it's just those two things.
It's crazy.
We've also got something else that's come up as well. I checked the service bulletin on Tesla Model 3s just the other day. Servicing the aircon done every 6 years.
Correct. That's an expensive one because they've got to drain the coolant, the refrigerant or what have you. So that's about $300. It works out to just under $400. But it's still, still very cheap. And that's, as you say, Alex, only done once every 6 years. So.
Yep.
But you don't have to do it. It's just a recommendation. And Harold's done close to 200,000K on his car. He's gone across the Nullarbor and he's never been to a service centre.
Yeah, I've done 189,786 kilometres.
There you go.
Yeah, hasn't Rob done 400 and something?
No, he's done 240 odd.
Nearly.
Jeff, the guy who does the Ubering in David's old car has done 200. He's just crossed over 250,000.
Yeah, right.
Awesome. Yeah.
10% degradation on that.
Oh, yeah.
Well, Richard Malik has had his car for 6 months, same time as I've had mine, same day, and he's up to 23,750 kilometres in his car for 6 months.
Wow, does he live in the car?
Well, he lives near Alex and Mandra, and his wife works in Midland. So,
well, he's busy doing lots of high speed chases away from the cop, up and down the Bunbury the Forest Highway.
Forest Highway, that would be it.
There's a guy in Germany or in Europe somewhere that's done 1 million kilometres on his Model S.
Germany.
He's done it with 2.5 batteries. I say 2.5 because he had the first one and there was a problem with it, but Tesla took it out and gave him a temporary one while they checked it out. And then when they checked it out, they said, yes, you do have a problem with it. And they took the temporary one out and gave him a new one all under the warranty. So he ended up having 2 and a bit batteries that he did the 1 million kilometres with.
Oh, wow.
Now, speaking of distance, and we're talking before about the issues with EVs as to whether it was cost or charging or whatever, this is the current or the latest map on Synergy's website. So what you need to do is go to Synergy, or Synergy's website, and just search EV Highway, and you'll see their map. So this is good for anyone that's looking at, you know, in a couple of years, doing some longer trips. So as you can see, all of the Southwest, well, a lot of the Southwest is covered, and you can go all the way to Connemara using fast AC chargers. The blue area is the Synergy service area, which is Southwest interconnected system, the Swiss, and then everything beyond that is Horizon Power's purview.
Yeah, the blue part is serviced by Western Power and the yellow part by Horizon.
Yeah. Of course, that doesn't include the those new charges up at Parabadu and Tom Price and Dampier as well. So it's going to cover the inland.
In fact, I know that Synergy said that they won't cover, if you get to Halls Creek, they're not going to cover your tyres if you park there longer than an hour when you're charging. So,
to Halls Creek, and yeah, it's an interesting place.
Oh, yeah.
My lip. Yeah, so as Ant was alluding to, where this charger is in Parabadu, which is right here. Do you know when it might be put on plug share? I guess we really need an EV to confirm it's working.
Yeah,
which is annoying because we were just
drive up there, I think.
Actually, let me go for a drive now. Construction.
It's a long way on DC, on AC charging. It kind of is. Yeah, if I only had time. Actually, that's a good little segue to, I did allude to it earlier, which was I had cause to go to Adelaide. And the great thing, and I sort of just flashed it up very briefly before, was the, as part of the Hertz Electric project, is Adelaide has 4 Model 3s available for rent. And I must admit, I was really spewing because I did look on their website a week ago with a view to obviously hiring a Model 3 if they were available. But I couldn't find them on the website, and I presumed, well, you know, they're not ready yet.
So you know how much they'll be hiring for?
They're not cheap. You can actually look on their website. You've sort of, the best way I've seen to do it is you just pick 2 dates. And then you just got to go all available at the airport, and you've just got to scroll down. I think it's a category D5 or something similar from memory. It's a EV some category. Actually, one thing that you can see on the actual image, if I zoom in, you can't zoom in, but it's actually J1772. It's got a type 1 plug as well as a type 2, which is really interesting. But I think it was about $700 for 3 days, so it's not cheap.
Why you had the Nissan Leaf, Harold?
No.
Don't say it, Harold.
The only time I Nissan Leaf was ever is on something like
viewers are advised that this recording may contain references to Synergy 2 weeks. Triggered by these or similar phrases should press pause and subscribe to the Nissan Lee channel.
I heard a program, they were talking about this Hertz system, and basically you'll just hire your car, you walk up with your phone, you'll open the car and you'll drive off, so you won't even see an attendant. So seamless process, sounds great to me.
Yes, and in fact, that was another piece of news I did see on Teslarati, was that there are signs for people that have been decomposing the Tesla app, or decompiling it, is signs of being able to move your profile from one car to the other.
Mm.
So it basically follows your app. So you know, people like us could go, well, to Adelaide and potentially, once this comes out, just hop into any Tesla and it'll be configured exactly like our own cars. which would be awesome because I'd like to have the ABC just in the lower left-hand corner of the screen.
And the pillow on the top.
So you know we're not doing that on there.
I have a question about the that synergy map. I'll actually have a look at that. That's great. That's but how do they propose to get these set up? Like, so Sandfly, for example, it was a nightmare to even convince them to let me charge at 5 kilowatt off their very shoddy gen set. And Lagrange, I mean, I wouldn't even have known where that was on that route. But that Sandfly to Broome, that's we arrived at the campsite with like 2Ks left. And that was sometimes going down to 80Ks an hour. So anyway, the point being that is a barren, yeah, Sandfire to Broome is a, well, there's nothing really, unless you're going to go off the main road.
To go to the Eco Beach, I went to Portsmouth Caravan Park.
Yeah. Oh, you can go, I mean, yeah, you can go to any caravan park in Australia that's got a powered site, and that's no problem. I didn't even bother adding campsites onto PlugShare because
But this was three phase, Richard.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that right.
Phase.
I think we might have been in a bit of a time pressure on that bit to get there. I think we wanted to get there. I'm going off on a tangent. My point is, how are Synergy proposing to get good power to these places? Are we talking a solar battery install?
Well, from Synergy's point of view, the good news is that it won't be them. It'll be Horizon, because Synergy only do the southwest.
Of course. Sorry. Yes, Horizon. Sorry.
Yes, that's cool. I'm only just taking the wee-wee. I think it's, yes, it is D5, Sports EV.
That's Adelaide.
91 per day.
191 a day, yeah.
Ah, cool.
Can you try to select, say, 3 days? Is it 3 times that, or is it a bit less, just out of interest? And I think it might.
That was from 10 o'clock one day to 10 o'clock the next. So I'll select two days. Hang
on. I just had a look. It's about $1,000 a week, but Suzuki Swift was $110 a day for the same period.
Yeah, right.
So interesting. It's got the long range wheels.
You can always get the Holden Barina. I think it's $57 a day. It's a comfortable car. You take out the seat.
Scroll down a bit. There we go. Oh. So how long, any days is that?
From the 6th of April to the 12th of April. So 6 days.
6 days, wow! That's a good deal. Oh well, I mean, you're picking SUVs, but still, I'll tell you what, the fuel costs would be a lot. Would be less certainly on the Model 3.
Yeah. There you go. Scroll down that page. Absolutely. That little red buzz bus at Economy A is still 150.
Economy A
Swift.
So rental cars are like hen's teeth at the moment because they've all gone off to mine sites.
Mm-hmm.
So there's nothing much less than 800 and whatever bucks, even on the Swift.
Yeah,
right. Well, I tell you what, I'd rather pay $1,300 for a Model 3 than $865 for a Swift any day.
Twice on Sunday.
Make that up in petrol. I mean, it just,
yeah,
no brainer.
Easily.
Well, the thing is, I hired a petrol Kona, and I mean, three of my kids have got Konas of different vintages, I'm not sure what generation your auto steer thing is. Does it have the indication where every time you hop in the car, you've got to enable it? And it's got two indications. There's the two lines that sort of like look like lane lines, and then you've got the steering wheel, and they're normally coloured white when it's not active, and then one of them turns green when it's sort of aware of where you are, but it's not helping you steer, but it will tell you if you're not steering
properly. To be honest, I switched on everything. I went through the manuals right in the beginning, and I've forgotten about it ever since. And I absolutely hate the way it does lane keep assist, because it acts like a ping pong. It just nudges you to say that, you know, go on, go back in the lane. I use cruise control, you know. The normal cruise control, but I don't bother with the lane keep assist because it's useless compared to the Tesla.
Absolutely. The thing that I thought was the worst, although I guess people would get used to it, is when it's a perfectly straight piece of road or it's a very mild bend, it will sort of perform quite well. But just as the bend tightens, it doesn't have like a beep or an alarm or anything else. It just stops steering and you start careening into the corner.
It's not by any stretch of the imagination. It's not an autopilot of any kind. It's pretty useless. As I said, it just nudges the steering wheel to tell you to stay in the lane. And I've tried to, on a straight road, sort of release the steering wheel and just watch it. And it sort of drifts to the left, ping-pongs away from the line, drifts to the right, ping-pongs away from the line, and does that. And sort of finds the middle, but it's not the same. It's not doing it by imaging. It's just doing it by, it's almost like it feels like it's running into a solid line.
Yes.
It's horrible.
So, you know, the difference is just chalk and cheese. So obviously, and that was in a price point in between the Swift and the Model 3. So, yeah, you know, it's a compelling offering to have Model 3s. Well, I must admit, you know, in South Australia, there aren't a hell of a lot of charging locations. I think we went to Murray Bridge, and there actually is a fast DC charger there. We did go to Clare, but I just didn't do it to myself to actually have a pilgrimage to the supercharger at Clare, because the last time I was there, I had to contemplate driving another 2,800 kilometres on AC charging. So I just didn't want to relive that experience of seeing these chargers in my rearview mirror, and taking a photo of it through the mirror, being all sad that the next 3 days are going to be arduous. But anyway, moving right along.
One day, we'll get first biofills across the Nullarbor, and then one day.
Oh,
maybe so see Harold, how arduous actually really is it to get across the Nullarbor? Because it's actually... it's something on the cards.
Oh, well, when I say arduous, I'll actually show you, Shane. It's actually not arduous.
Good night, everyone.
Good night, Carmen.
Bye.
So here's the difference between something that's arduous. Oh, there's so many charges. This is ridiculous.
Yeah, that's just ridiculously good. Okay, let's just park that. We understand that.
Well, let's just highlight this for a moment. I drove from Canberra down to Melbourne, across to Keith in one day. That's 1,200 kilometres, and I spent less than 2.5 hours of supercharging. And in fact, I probably wasted about 20 minutes because I overcharged in Melbourne while I was talking to the sales guys at Richmond. The opposite is driving from Perth to Carnarvon, which that was before John Edwards's Caltex Durian Bay fast DC charger. And that was before Tokwa's Geraldton fast DC charger. So it was all slow charging all the way. And from Perth to Carnarvon is 907 Ks. And that took 7 hours and 5 minutes of sitting beside the car while it was charging. I had so much time that when I went to Geraldton, I had enough time to go from the Gerald Apartments just here to, I had to walk, I think it was a kilometre and a half to the, I think it was over here to where the aquatic center was, and I managed to basically walk that, bash out a kilometer swimming, get changed, walk back, and I still had time left over on that day. So that was 7 hours and 5 minutes of daytime charging. But as far as the Nullarbor goes, so I overnighted at Keith, which is just outside of Adelaide, going west, went through Adelaide and then Clare. That was the last good charge. I went to the big battery near Jamestown, which is just sort of up there. Went through Port Augusta and then overnighted at Kimber. So that was...
Do you have 22 kilowatts charging in yours?
No.
No.
You only got the single, right?
No.
17 and a half, I think.
It's sort of... I can gain 70 kilometres of range per hour, which is the same as the Model 3s can get with their 11 kilowatt charges. Yeah. It's about 70 odd kilometres. In fact, the new SR Pluses or the new Model 3s get in excess of 80 kilometres an hour. So overnighted at Kimber and then drove to Border Village. So charged up at Sejuna and then at Nullarbor Roadhouse. Penong. So basically from Kimber to Sejuna, topped a bit up at Penong, Nullarbor Roadhouse, and then overnighted at Border Village. And then from Border Village went straight.
So that was a one-day trip from Kimber all the way to Border Village.
Yes. Yep.
Wow.
Yeah. So I've actually got
like 4 hours. 4 hours charging on the way, like 4 hours of stopping.
Oh, it was more than 4 hours charging. And what you do is just break it up. So I would normally leave in the morning as like I did my trip in late-ish November, so there was plenty of daylight hours. And I'd only really drive from daybreak to dark, from dawn to dusk. I don't drive at night. What I do is basically, make sure the car was 100% charged, obviously, when I woke up. Drive to the first charging spot and have breakfast there. Or I'd have breakfast on my lap, which is usually like a couple of Weet-Bix and a UHT milk thing in a bowl. In fact, you sort of learn to like not even have to use the bowl. You just have the Weet-Bix, have a chomp of that and scull a bit of milk.
The struggle is real.
While you're on autopilot, driving perfectly safely, of course. So the Nullarbor takes... Well, put it this way, I went from Keith to Kimber in one day, from Kimber to Border Village in another day, and from Border Village to Norseman in another day. And then obviously from Norseman you can get to Perth one more day, but I actually went down to Esperance and then to Albany and overnighted at Albany, sort of deliberately doing a bit of a longer version of the trip. And then, Albany too.
So realistically, to get to Eyre Peninsula, so this side, you would be, it'd be a day from here to Norseman, a day from Norseman to the border, and then the next day and you're there.
Yeah, so if you want to do it the quickest way, you'd go via Kalgoorlie. Do it a day, and you could probably get close to bashing out to Norseman. Right, so you get to Norseman in one day, and then from Norseman you can get to Border Village easily, very easily, and then from Border Village you can get to.
But down about where your mouse is where I want to get to, give or take. Ish there somewhere.
Yes.
No, more like Coffins.
Call it Port Lincoln. Hey Shane, have you ever driven across to Nullarbor at all?
Many times.
Oh, okay, cool. In a normal car?
In a normal car, yeah. Okay. I've done that trip in... When I've done that trip before, I've done it in 24 hours.
Yeah, yeah. Like
Two drivers, non-stop type.
Yeah, well, I drove to Melbourne in a truck
with another a staff member of mine, and we did it in 46 hours in a truck. One thing I definitely would never do in my life is drive across the Nullarbor during the night. Driving the truck across the night was a scary enough, but during the night in a car, not a chance, not without a bull bar, some sort of protection.
Yeah. I'd be too scared. I've done that a few times too, which actually helps the range. Yeah. Would help the range on the car because you just sit behind a truck.
Yeah, you find a truck and slip through. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, that's the only way I would do stuff if I had to go in a car. I'd sit behind a semi, definitely, and tell the driver that I'm there. And
I actually have done the Nullarbor myself several times, and I did just that. I sat behind a truck, but unfortunately, the truck was sucking in the kangaroos behind it, and they were hitting me.
Yeah. Yeah, they do that.
The issue is not so much the kangaroos, it's the wombats. Is they're quite solid when they come out the back of the truck.
The thing that I didn't like was the fact that you're on a bit of road that's not very wide, and that you're between your truck mirror on your right side and the truck mirror coming the opposite way on his side, there'd be a gap of about 350 mil, and you could feel it. And that used to frighten the shit out of me every night. And then, waiting for the truck to come and overtake, it's not overtake, but come the other way, would take a good 40 minutes till they'd be doing that. And then the one thing that amazed me was the truck that I had was limited to 105 Ks, and that was it. And I'd get a semi come up behind me, and it was a triple trailer, which is 57 meters long.
Yeah.
And he'd say, I'm just going to overtake you, mate, all clear. And I'd go, yeah. And he would just leave me, and then tell me to put my high beam back on. It's not going to bother him. And, it was just crazy. But the wildlife on the road, crazy stuff, absolutely.
It's worse if you've had a bit of rain. It's fine. It's not so bad if it's been dry, but as soon as there's a bit of rain, the water sits on the side of the road, and it gets pretty lively.
I know that the truckies love it because the WA police on Border Village do not work after 6 o'clock at night. It's under their constitution of health and safety. It's too dangerous for them to patrol the roads, and they don't patrol.
Is that right?
They don't patrol the roads after 6 o'clock at night. Until 6 or 6 in the morning, they don't patrol the roads. It's too dangerous. They'll set up in the city, in the actual the town, but they won't go out and patrol roads.
Oh. Well, you guys talking about animals on the Nullarbor.
I did Ceduna
to Perth in a day. It's literally the crack of dawn, which was like 4:40 during the summer. Yeah. And I did not see, once I got across or onto the Nullarbor, I did not see a single animal other than a couple of birds the entire way through. And my son was like, no camels, no roos, no wombats, no nothing. It was eerie bizarre.
Well, I ran over about 3 wombats. I hit about 4 kangaroos. And I know the other truck that was travelling further back behind us, he got an eagle that smashed his passenger side window on his truck. So it's pretty eye-opening stuff. And the eagle was basically eating the kangaroo and just took his time to take off, and the truck didn't slow down, and away you go, So
I smashed the passenger side of the front windscreen with an owl. An owl just flew out of the bush, and bang, just hit the passenger side, the corner, and smashed that whole window up near Exmouth in a VK Commodore station wagon.
Well, the farm animals love to lay on the road at night because it's warm. The tar's hot, so they lay on the road to keep warm because it's freezing cold out there, and that's what the problem is. That jackknife, that truck just recently was a camel. He hit a camel, so ended up jumping off his truck.
I was with Jeffa. I drove from Perth to Melbourne, and I didn't stop until I got to Penong. I ran out of petrol, which is another story, but basically There were two.
Hang on, Harold. Sorry, Harold. You drove an EV all the way around Australia without running out of charge, but you managed to run out of fuel at Penang.
He had a bad drug dealer. He didn't get the right car.
It was an AU Fairmont. And the trip meter lied. So on my way to Kalgoorlie, I thought I could make it the whole way because I said I could. And I ran out, I don't know, 30 Ks out of Coolgardie. And that was the first, that one trip. And someone gave me a lift and blah, blah, blah. And then the next time was after going through Border Village. I forget what the next station was, but it was shut because I left home at about 4:30 in the morning, sort of just at dawn or whatever, or just before dawn. And I got to Penang at, I don't know, 2 or something, and Sojourner at, I think it's about 4 o'clock in the morning. And I rang on the, I went to the Sojourner motel or whatever it was, and rang on the doorbell and got a room. But I had so many Diet Cokes on the way on the trip. I was so wired that I couldn't sleep. I was laying in bed, trying to sleep, going, it's, you know, I've been up for so long and I couldn't sleep. And so I just thought at about 6 o'clock, I just went, I might as well just get up. So I just got up, hopped back in the car and then continued on to Melbourne. And I think the Perth to Melbourne trip was about 36 hours. But the thing that scared me the most, like Jeff, I saw nothing pretty much all the way to Sojourner. But when I got to Melbourne, I think it's near Bacchus Marsh when you got the Eastern or the Western Freeway or whatever it is, you got two lanes each way and it's very sort of hilly and you've got Armco to your left and so like just an abyss, you know, beyond it, and it's dark, it's nighttime. And there were kangaroos jumping out of the blackness, like out of nothing, over the Armco onto the road. And I was just pulling my pants to the point where trucks were overtaking me like I was standing. So I was doing like 80 Ks an hour, absolutely shooting bricks, thinking I've driven 3,000 Ks and not damaged the car. I'm not going to do it, you know, 50 Ks from Melbourne. And I'll never forget seeing this. You know, like you got the 70 series Land Cruisers. This was like some old, this was like in, what's that, Lion movie in Born Free. Born Free. What, like one of those ancient, you know, Land Cruisers or Land Rovers or whatever. And I'll never forget seeing this thing that looked like a body, looked like a pig on the road, but it was actually like this massive kangaroo. And then about 300 meters beyond it was this old Land Rover or Range Rover or whatever stopped, and the front of its grill and the whole front of it was just caved in as it hit this huge roof, which stopped this thing dead. And yeah, I just limped into Melbourne, you know, really scared of what was, you know, around the corner.
It's funny, I had New South Wales, but I did Newcastle to Perth. And New South Wales, I thought, I might see some interesting. I have never seen more goats in my life.
Yeah.
WA is renowned for kangaroos. New South Wales, you take the cage of goats. I couldn't get over it.
That's why when you get to Carnarvon, you don't drive nighttime for the rest of the way because there's goats, open track goats, no fences, all the way from Carnarvon up towards, not Exmouth, but with the turn off to Exmouth. All the truck drivers know it and they pull over and sleep behind the roadhouse in Carnarvon and then they take off at 6 in the morning when they can see the road and then start driving again.
I can't wait for the side of the truck. It's going to be fun.
Oh, yeah.
For the cyber truck, country driving and stuff, has anybody got the paint protection film stuff on the cars to stop all the stone chips and all that sort of stuff?
Yeah, Richard Cooper, of course, and Nigel. I'm actually going to do it as well. Yes, I haven't done it yet.
I just don't like the cost.
Yeah, it's expensive cost, but it's all going to be more expensive repairing it.
What colour car are you getting, Todd?
We're getting the standard Tesla white.
Is it Poverty Pearl White or just...
That's the one, Poverty Pearl White.
I cannot.
Poverty Pearl White.
We're evangelistic, you know, we're telling the world we're here.
Well, I've had mine on for all 2 years and it saved me 3 paint repairs, but my cars are blue and it means when I wash the car, I don't have to be careful. I can just hose it off and chamois it, and because you can't scratch the stuff, it's self-healing. So you don't get swirls in your paint. So that's another advantage.
Hey, what do you mean it's self-healing? This is like some Transformers shit going on here.
Yeah. No, it's as soon as it gets hot, if you've got any swirling, it just melts and goes away. And
always you get a hair dryer out, apparently, and wife
blow you don't it, have, it. You don't have to.
If you do get a scratch, Todd, Chris Lim has got a really good product that he found or showed
us. That's only on paint, though. You can't do that on...
Yeah, no, we can do it. Chris Lim will tell you the paint. It's got a 3-pack system that you can use.
But if
you get any scratches and stuff.
Yeah. If you've got paint protection film, you've then got a problem.
Yeah, I got my first chip the other day. Not on the front, though, actually above the right left-hand side tyre on that rim part.
Oh, yeah.
Just comes around because stupid roadworks in the area.
Yeah.
Yeah, so what's the film cost like, and has anybody else thought about doing it?
Yes.
I had my whole car done, including I had everything tinted, half the roof tinted and the side things tinted and paint protection film and some other coating on the windows. It was $5,000, so it wasn't cheap.
Cool. Yeah, it's not going to be cheap.
I invested, I think it was about $50 in the little stone mud guard things.
Mud flat?
Yeah, mud flat. But they look plastic. Little
on mine too.
Harold's got the disco music going again.
There's a mirror ball going to pop in any minute now.
He doesn't even know he's doing it anymore.
I've got a question. Joe, come in, Joe. Joe, are you there?
Yeah, hello, Joe's Joe. There.
Joe's on the night shift.
I've got a question for you. What are the lunches for tomorrow? You're not ironing. Yeah, I'm just wondering what lunches we got for tomorrow.
I haven't started yet. I'm doing other stuff.
Okay, can we get an update later maybe?
Yeah, I've got the lunchbox. I literally they are sat next to the computer ready and I haven't done them yet.
Okay. Well, it's normally 10:30. I would like to find out what lunches.
Yeah, okay.
All right. Thanks, Joe.
All right.
Have a look at, I think, is it Dentless? They do a decent PPF type shit I've seen as well. And the quote I got, I think, was about $19.95 for a whole heap of stuff, including the paint protection and all that sort of stuff. But yeah, Dentless has got some good reviews.
Dentless.
Well, what about Harold? What PPF did you put on, Harold? You've driven around Australia.
I've banged out 189,000 kilometres, and I can tell you that I've got zero PPF at all. And I do have a couple of paint chips, stone chips, but they literally look exactly the same today as they did 3 years ago. Because it's all an aluminium skin, it doesn't corrode, it doesn't degrade, it just looks the same as it did the day it happened. So,
what colour is yours, Harold?
It's a colour you can't get. It's called titanium silver. It's one of those ideal colours that when the car gets dirty, it just goes from being shiny to slightly dull. It doesn't really change colour. But, I just haven't paid for the PPE, but I can absolutely understand people that do because, you know, you can get a stone chip. It does tear the PPE, but you can just change that one sheet. You don't have to respray a whole bonnet or a whole, bumper or whatever.
That's PPF, Harold. PPF. It's Jared Nurses with the PPE.
Yes.
But it's PPE for the car, mate. PPE for the car. That's what it is. Yes,
now coming up now, since I've worked out this audio thing, is got to do with people that like to pretend to save the environment while looking rich. And I'm not sure if we're going to get a copyright strike, but I'm going to give it a go anyway. So here we go.
As a Tesla owner, my self-identity is wrapped up in my car.
And I can confidently tell you that the best way to care for their environment is to drive a $110,000 electric car because it has zero emissions. And I want you to know from the bottom of my Tesla-owning heart to you, if you don't drive a Tesla, then you're selfish and clearly hate the environment.
Luxury Enviro Shame.
Caring about the environment's the convenient rationalization I use to cover up real motivation for buying a Tesla. Materialism and wanting the status it gives me. But as a Tesla owner, I don't acknowledge this truth, and neither should you. Instead, I'd rather just have you think I'm rich and that I care about the environment. How in the hell do you close this thing? F***ing hell. Got it. I love to carbon shame people for driving regular cars. They have the carbon footprint of a Sasquatch in a China shop. I have no idea why people drive regular gas-guzzling cars instead of a six-figure zero-emissions Tesla like me. I just don't get it. Teslas are the $20 green juice of cars. You have no idea why you're drinking it, but you do because everyone else in the upper middle class community is, and you want to feel included. A secret that all Tesla owners know is you no longer have to do something admirable to be admired. You just have to own a Tesla. And here's some accurate assumptions that all people think when they see someone driving a Tesla. They're forward thinking. That person's probably a highly successful programmer earning at least $200,000 a year. That person's better than me. I'll bet they listen to audiobooks. They must solve problems at a global level. They probably worked out on their Peloton bike this morning in their high-rise apartment. That person's single-handedly ending global warming. I'll bet they have a lot of charisma, yet like to keep to themselves. They probably founded Facebook. When I'm not carbon-shaming people, I love to focus on the Tesla features I can't live without. There's so many that I don't remember most of them, and therefore they all add value to my life. Each one that I do remember takes me an average of only 11 minutes of frustration and struggle to remember how to activate. Some of my favorite features are nothing makes me feel more stress and terror than when I completely give up control of my car as I relax into self-driving mode. And it makes me think that I'm important enough that I don't have time to drive my car when I'm riding in my car. It also enables me to more safely indulge in my self-destructive lifestyle of drinking too much wherever I go.
Video games.
What do people desperately want but never get when they're buying a luxury gas-guzzling car? A video game system. But as a Tesla owner, I get this incredibly useful feature. Now when I arrive at my destination, instead of getting out of my car, I stay in my car for hours playing the world's most expensive video game system.
Ludicrous mode.
Going from 0 to 60 in 3 seconds is lame. So for an extra 20K, I get ludicrous mode, so I can go from 0 to 60 in 2.4 seconds. That extra 0.6 seconds has changed my life. And I enjoy the sensation of having my kidneys liquefied and my stomach being pulled up through my throat when I use ludicrous mode to impress my friends.
I almost crapped myself.
No, you actually did.
Doors that open upward.
My Tesla Model X has doors that open upward, and that makes me feel like a Michael J. Fox in Back to the Future, just with less Parkinson's disease. And they make me think that people are admiring me instead of thinking I look like an idiot. I've also closed the door on each of my children's heads multiple times.
Song and dance mode.
The feat of engineering that lets my Tesla sing and dance to my favorite Christmas song and the increased cost because of it brings unspeakable joy to me for approximately one Instagram video over the course of my vehicle's lifetime. When my Tesla needs servicing, I enjoy having to wait a couple weeks for an appointment. The fact that he doesn't let regular shops work on their cars gives me the luxurious experience of waiting and not being able to drive my car. And that makes me feel the value of exclusivity. It's like waiting in a long line to get into a club. Yeah, there's other clubs I could go into, but this one has the longest line, so I think I'll wait. As a Tesla owner, I have a borderline problematic obsession with Elon Musk. He's the most inspirational person to ever walk the planet. Elon's what would happen if you had the sex appeal of Stephen Hawking and combined it with the innovative genius of a non-asshole Steve Jobs, along with the social skills of Rain Man. I'm always on his tweets like they're the last open charging station in a Whole Foods parking lot. And I'm either too dumb to understand how his tweets make any sense, or he's too socially awkward to use words in a way that makes any sense. Either way, I love him. And I sleep better at night knowing I'm a part of Elon's world. And I am totally on board with colonizing Mars. It seems like it'd be enjoyable to live there. As an electrically powered Tesla owner, it's important for me not to consider where my electricity comes from and how it's probably generated by burning coal and therefore produces large amounts of carbon emissions. That inconvenient truth would threaten my very generous pretend devotion to the environment. But do you know what is good for the environment? Not knowing that the mining of the rare earth minerals that go into making the enormous lithium-ion Tesla batteries generates large amounts of greenhouse gases. Instead, I just focus on the things that I'm willing to acknowledge, like how being a Tesla owner makes me a good person who cares about the environment. It makes me feel like I'm feeding the hungry without having to give them any food. And that makes me feel pretty good about myself. Thank you, Tesla. Thank you for watching. Please be sure to subscribe to my channel and turn on the notifications so you can be annoyed each time I post a new video. And also check out my website for my live comedy show tour schedule, linked in the description below. As a Tesla owner, my self-identity is wrapped up in my car. Yeah. That'll be on the takes.
So there you go. And that's a shout out.
Got somebody who's just joined us now, Gary, who his partner's just put a money down for an LR.
Oh, Gary, welcome. And congratulations to you, to your partner.
You there, Gary? He's trying to figure out how to talk
on Zoom. He's probably on a phone, which makes it difficult.
All right. Anyway, you can carry on.
Yeah, that's cool. Well,
hey there. Sorry.
So Jared, how was that that generous temperature reading that you just got?
They're still doing it right now. Actually, they're testing. They just tested my arm. Now they're testing my blood to see that my level. Make sure it's okay. Cool. Yeah, I thought that video was good. Where'd you get that from, Harold?
That was actually Awakened with JP. So I'm going to flick
it. It actually looked a lot like Richard Cooper about 30 years ago. Yes. I saw a lot of similarity between that guy and Richard Cooper.
You're a sick man, Jared. I went there in hospital.
I tell you what I really appreciated was the Christmas show lights that we did last Wednesday, Damien's burnt orange and Harold's next to each other doing the exact same. I thought that was, and Pete, I think you got it, Pete, didn't you? You videoed it. I was actually, I was really impressed.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah. Look, Damon, and a big shout out to you, Damon, because you do watch us. Oh, actually, well, I'll finish that little comment. You do watch us in half hour slabs, but Jared, We earlier lamented the absence of a true friend of this channel.
Yes.
Russell. And I did get a text back at 7:15, but I couldn't be bothered reading it, so I'm going to read it now. And it says,
from Russell?
Yeah, from Russell. Hey, mate, we'll need to send my apologies tonight. I'm in blank at the moment and will be a bit late for me. We'll catch you up via YouTube. So
we've missed you tonight, Russell, and I was looking forward to some of the questions that you're going to bring on to give Pete a bit of a run, because you always give Pete a bit of a run. It's always good.
Yeah, so we'll see you next week, Russell.
What we're going to do, Jared, is we're going to pause. Oh, that was hilarious.
Oh, no, there is something there, Harold.
I have no idea. I mean, how can you do that? Seriously.
No, there's obviously some operation stuff that he did. So, you know.
I'm bloody glad you turned it off. That could have been bad.
It could have been shocking.
I know. But anyway, we've got a few screen captures and it's all good. So it's between us and ourselves.
Yeah.
So shout out to you, Russell. Apologies. I only just read it on my phone a little while ago. I've been kind of busy trying to sort out audio problems, as you've seen, but we got it all sorted in the end. But yeah, so shout out to Russell. Look forward
Hopefully we'll see you next week, Russell.
We'll have a special segment. I don't know what we'll call it. What should we call it, Jared? Russell's
Corner. I mean, he you know. Russell's
Corner, we got.
Yeah, I'm not sure I have to work on that one.
We've got Dr. Dix.
Hang on a sec. I think he's going to sleep. Hang on, Debbie.
No, I'm sending you a message.
He's gone to sleep. There we go. Sorry.
So pray tell, Jared, but how did you do that?
I can't give that secret away just yet. But let's say it's a bit of progress that we're working on at the moment, Harold, ourselves. And it's certainly changed my life where I don't spend any time just doing this at the moment. But, we're getting there. Yeah, it's a long story, but, yeah.
We might just uncloak this little happening. Oops.
Look,
It's called one of those. Oh, no, it's gone in chroma key.
Oh, really?
Because I've chroma keyed it.
It's called this.
And I can't be bothered fixing it. Yes, exactly.
What is that?
It's called a Stream Deck. So it's a programmable, what would you call it? It's like a programmable keyboard, really. And the awesome thing is what Jared's showing is you can actually, you basically create icons for every push button. And then as you press them, it can do things like macros. To your computer. So you can sort of pretend to be a lot more professional than you really are. As Tesla podcasters and YouTubers, we like to think that we're doing our bit for the wider community. Not.
But, it's a slow learning curve.
It's a very steep one. I'll give you a giant tip. But, it's all good fun. Now, a little while ago, we were talking about, not getting the real car because, they were like a toy car instead. So I was really upset when someone got me this. And it was like, that's not a real Cybertruck. And then they went, actually, we've got a bigger version, would that be okay? And it's like, no, that's just not happening. And then someone said, well, what about this one? Is that good enough as a Cybertruck? And it's like, I mean, come on. Just not happening.
Is that one of the remote control ones, Harold?
Yes, Anne. Yeah. The sad thing is that even though this thing, I've got a bit of chroma key happening again. Even though this thing is lithium ion battery powered, the remote control isn't, and it needs two AA batteries. And I just haven't been bothered to go and get some. So
I know I'm not the only one. I did the exact same thing, Aaron. I've got it, and it sits there and looks pretty, but I've never driven it because of the exact same thing.
It's just.
You guys go to Bunnings?
Yeah, I do, but I always forget. It's Bunnings, right? So you go to Bunnings and you have to get two things, and you walk out with everything else except the two things
went to get.
And the
hot
dog. Exactly.
You always got to go back. So have you guys?
This remote, which is what you get. And you know, it's just got two well, it might be four AAs actually. Looks like it's four. Maybe it is four. And I just haven't gotten around to it. Just like Jeffa, I just, you've only got one thing to do. And well, actually, you've got two things to do, and you only work out what that one thing was and forget the other one.
At the fire station meetup, we were playing with both of those. What's his name? Burnt Red Orange Man. He had them both. Damien. Our kids were playing with them. So one had the mini one. And obviously at the fire station car park, it was a huge area. And one had the bigger one, and it was really good. It was really responsive, and the bigger one. The little one was not so good, but it was still working. But, yeah, there were a few little crashes. I was quite scared because they'd literally just taken it out the box, and my child was driving the big one and kept crashing into the fire trucks and things. But, yeah, they were really good. But, yeah, a bit ironic, like the Cybertruck, like racing around next to a big fire truck.
Yeah, it will be interesting.
Tessas are famous for banging into emergency vehicles, so
so great.
Why shouldn't the Cybertruck be the same?
Yeah.
Boom boom. Well, come on, Jared. Wait, have you got that keyed up? You got the boom tish?
I was reading Richard. Was that you, Richard Cooper, sending me a thing? I've got a. It took me all day to program four buttons. I'm still working on it. All right, it's not easy. I tell you, I've signed up this thing with Harold, and I tell you, it's a fucking not.
You guys,
it's very powerful. It's going to change Harold's performance, definitely, of being able to bring delivery of the product to the consumer yourselves a lot easier to understand. So it will make a
Patreon only channel that's going to be just look out, Rickard, and look out,
look out, Jim Cramer.
Jim Cramer.
Speaking of
buttons, Mad Money,
he's a champion.
Have you guys seen those programmable sexy buttons, the four buttons you can get for your Tesla? They're programmable. We'll put them in, and you assign them Bluetooth to your car, and they'll do things like you can press a button, it'll open your trunk, or you can press a button, it'll, yeah.
This button thing, you can label anything you want, even spin it around and make it rotate visually. You know, it can do all kinds of things. It can warn you. It can turn your lights on. It can turn everything on. It doesn't just do sound effects. It can throw a video on the screen. You can do everything. And it's, you know, it's a $400 item. It's amazing what it can do. Someone like you, Pete, head of the curve, if you were still doing your
Can you see that as one screen?
So
for instance, I've got the main, the news, the 2 weeks, the Tesla share price, the screen, that's the screen video. I've got a couple of versions of 2 weeks, plug share, YouTube. So when you press the plug share button, it just opens a web page instantly that has PlugShare or YouTube. The MCU actually opens the PowerPoint presentation that's got my MCU simulator for the Model 3. Tesla's just Tesla's web page. You know, we've got the personal advice, audio.
See, that's quite a few more buttons than four, Jared. He's done quite well then.
Yeah, well, he had an extra day on me. He wasn't in hospital getting oxygen put on him and getting attacked by nurses. Next week I'm coming from my funeral. I'm never going to miss a week. So next week we'll be doing it live from my eulogy.
Jared, I like how you say attacked by nurses, like you think it's a bad thing.
Well, some of the nurses have, you know, they're, you know, they went to school with Richard Cooper, which is nice. Don't get me wrong, they're lovely ladies, but, you know, I did have two 18-year-old nurses wake me up the other morning, and I was like, my God, am I have? I thought I was actually in heaven. I thought I died and woke up in heaven. I was like, wow.
If we've got 18-year-old nurses in hospitals now, we are really struggling with
the. Oh, yeah, there was three 18-year-olds on that morning. One was a training one, and the other two were registered or something. They're not fully.
They must be, so they're ENs, not RNs.
Yeah, right. Yeah. And there's lots of those. And there's so a lot of casuals now. In there. But they said they're full of stuff. They've got a lot of stuff here. So, yeah, pretty impressive.
Harold, you had a button on there that says mute Mike. Who's Mike?
Aha, very good. Can I share my screen for a minute?
Yeah, go for it.
Of course again.
Are you going to show your ballroom dancing?
This is serious. These buttons, you seen these things?
I've seen something about these. Yeah.
This one.
No, yeah.
Oh.
But I'm still trying to work out what I would use them for.
They are stick-on, so you can put them literally anywhere you want in your car. I'm going to show you where I'm going to put mine. These are powered by lithium little coin cells. So, you know, these are not throwaway items. So when the battery dies, you can just replace them on your own. Actually, they do spell sexy, S-E-X-Y. Kind of a nice little touch there. Let me show you the other stuff you get in the box. You get the actual CAN bus module called the Commander. Talk about that here in a second. And you get a trim removal tool. Now, the way this installs is that in the back of the center console of the Model 3 or the Model Y, you use the trim removal tool to remove the little small panel. You use the supplied splicer cable. When I say splitter, I'm not talking about cutting any wires. This is completely reversible. Doesn't affect your warranty or anything like that. It plugs into the wiring harness. And then in the other end, you get this CAN bus module where the Commander plugs in. Once you plug in the Commander module in your car, you then go to the app on your phone, you connect to it, and you can start programming the buttons. Let me show you how easy this is to use. I've got my button here, Commander app. I'm going to press this button, press and hold. And that button is now registered. Maybe you want under acceleration to be switchable between chill and sport. You've got different options here under regen braking. Maybe you want it to open the charge port, kind of handy. Under this setting here, you have various different options for opening and closing. Glove box, yes, that's what I want, save. This one's really handy. My wife is always asking about opening the glove box. So now I can just press the button and it opens the glove box. See how fast that was? Look at that. Cool. I'm gonna put this one on the back of the screen. Right there. Maybe you want it to open the trunk or the front trunk. And there's some other settings in here. Turn on the hazard lights. Yeah, let's try that. Yeah, look how fast that is. Look at that. Turn it off. Man, this is instantaneous. It's awesome. Fold the mirrors. Sure. Oh, I love it. Look at that. Let's add a second button. Tap that. Pair. There you go. Now I can set this one to be something else.
That's cool.
Let's try the trunk. Don't forget, my car has the aftermarket, the Henshaw one. Works like a charm. Extra bonus in the app. Look at this, charge port rear handle. You have that enabled. Your car's locked. You can't open the charge port. Just push on the door handle just a little bit and it opens. Isn't that cool? Frunk left handle, same thing. Frunk, open the frunk. Just see, just open my frunk.
That I like.
Maybe you have the option to do it from the passenger side if you want as well, but not something that I'm going to use. But this is really handy though.
Yeah, that's cool.
That I like. So, a few things you need to know about these buttons is that.
Anyway, I thought I'd show you.
Whoa. No. You did. That's actually really interesting.
Let me keep going.
Yeah,
you keep going. Okay. Yeah. Each kit includes four, so you can buy two kits if you really want. But, you know, for me, four is probably just enough. The little rings around them, these are interchangeable, by the way. So maybe they'll come out with different colors in the future. I don't know. But anyways, they're interchangeable. So if you get a black kit and you want to mix it up with white and black, these just pop off. Again, just reiterate, these are not throwaway. You can actually change the coin cell battery in there if they ever die. And off you go. But you can see that it's instantaneous. There's the mirrors. I can think of so many different things with these. Matter of fact, before I even got the buttons, I actually reached out to the company and I thought, you know, there's some extra functionality I'd like to see with these, maybe a double click or even a triple click to add more functionality so we can do different things. And they tell me that is something that's coming in a future software update. Here's another thing that I thought of, not only the glove box, because my wife is also back asking about that, but I do a lot of drives with people. And as you know, as a Model 3 owner or even a Model Y owner, explaining people how the doors work can get a little tiring. I would love to be able to do a triple click on this, obviously in park, of course, to be able to pop open the passenger side door or maybe any of the other doors. I've reached out to the company. I suggested that to them. Possibility, they'll think about it, but they do have a form on their website. So if you think of some other functions that you'd like to see.
That would be fantastic.
They will take a look at it. But the possibilities with this are absolutely endless. And I have just started to scratch the surface of what I can do with these things. Matter of fact, I'm going to take my buttons and I'm going to put them behind my screen so that they're not visible. Like I said, these are stick-on. You can put them anywhere you want in the car. So you can put it on your center console.
We do not have a mandatory vaccination policy in this country.
I have a performance Model 3. I'll be able to turn on track mode with this. This is pretty awesome. And then the other two, actually, I'm going to put them behind the yoke on my car, and then I'll assign some function to that. I haven't decided what I'm going to do with that. You know what? I'm kind of sold on these things. I don't like buttons. You know, we get so used to the car, but I think this opens up so many possibilities because they're programmable. You can make them do anything you want. Again, with other cars, the buttons are built into the car and that's their function. They will never change. But these things are brilliant. Now, again, I'll put a link in the video description if you guys are interested in getting these. So they'll be available through Abstract Ocean, and I'll have a discount coupon code. Word of warning, of course, because the world is suffering from a chip shortage. If you're interested in some of these, maybe for Christmas, get your order in as soon as possible. I think you guys should take a serious look. If you're looking at maybe doing some automation in your car, it's totally awesome. Put them anywhere you want. Program them at will. I mean, who'd have thought? Anyways, if you like the video, give it a thumbs up. Leave a comment below. Tell me what you think. Don't forget to subscribe. We'll see you later. Thanks for watching. I'm gonna play with these things. I got some pretty
new. Well, if he hasn't done it already, I can imagine Chris Lim going to the website right now, pressing the button because he's the gadget freak.
I can see Richard Cooper buying about 20 of them, walking down James Street in a trench coat, selling them. Want your button? Want your button?
Hey, you guys have never been.
How much?
Do you reckon that'd work outside the car too? So if I stickied one of those onto the wall of my garage, do you reckon that'd unlock my charge port for me?
Ooh, great.
Yeah, I reckon it would.
Stick it on your type 2.
Yeah, it's obviously connected
on the top of me yes. what's that thing called? That, you know the one I mean. The three-phase one.
Why would you need to, Shane?
The cones charger.
That's the one I've got called now.
The cones charger.
Don't you just? Oh, I see. To get it out.
No.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, you could do that too.
To get it in,
just stick it on top of the charger, and then boop, and then out it comes, like a Tesla charger would.
Yeah.
Yeah, I imagine. Sonny,
I'm with you. Yeah, great idea.
Actually, Shane, you can buy those because Tesla just uses.
Yeah, I know. But to do that, to fit that, the ones that you can buy, well, one, they're $150, and to fit it, I've got to pull the plug apart, lay into it with my die grinder, and make a hole. And yeah, I.
Hey, Chris, how much do they cost, mate? You looked it up.
$116 for four.
Oh, sweet. Yes, I'm already in front. That's magic.
Australian.
Does that include the OBD connector?
Hang on, I'll show you the website. I might as well share it because I'm there already.
Chris is all over.
I think you're on mute, Harold.
Chris, have you ordered it already?
No. They're actually not available yet. Hang on. Does it say they're available? Yeah, they are. So
click the button quick.
That says 2 seconds.
$271 with the OBD connector. That's actually quite a lot.
That's
so they're not cheap.
What's it called? Sexy buttons. Okay.
Sexy button.
Yeah, S3XY.
You guys have never been so quiet for 10 minutes. You realize that, don't you?
No.
That's because we're all buying stuff, mate.
This is I'm drugged up.
Problem is, Richard, we've got so many CAN bus things to fit in there that you're going to run out of room because there's no room in there.
I know. That's what I was thinking. I have to build a bigger pile for it.
Actually, my car's already got a Y adapter for my CAN bus because I've got two modules. One for my, one's for a program I wrote myself for the battery, and the other one's Scan My Tesla, but for iPhone, and you need a different dongle. So I've got a dongle Y splitter. Now I need like a three-way splitter to put this other dongle on the CAN bus.
You just keep daisy chaining.
Two or more daisy chain them?
Yeah, you just put it in parallel, but you need a Y adapter, which is one OBD thing to two, but I need one that goes from one to three.
You just add another one to two to the one to two to one to two to one to two.
Do that too as well.
One.
I can't wait.
One, two. Sound like somebody who works in a band, someone we know.
Oh, yeah, live the good life. Just do mods every week. Yeah.
I thought you had retired, Jared.
Oh, not yet. I've still got a couple more years left in me, mate.
No, I'm in forced retirement, mate, you poor bastard.
No. Got a couple more years to go.
Just one or two.
You're only working for two more weeks, though, aren't you, Jared?
No, I'm not really working till next year, I think. So, yeah, I'm taking the rest of this year off.
Really? Yeah.
Two weeks. At least it's not this.
On that chord, I think I'll depart.
Ant, I've got a question for you.
Oh, yeah? Carol's quite finished.
That guitarist does look a bit like Pete. Not that one. Wait for him. Harold, you know every time you play that, Pete gets another 2 weeks in the doghouse, don't you? Every time you play that.
Do you know what? I actually did the other day. I took a girl for a lap in the car and we accelerated. And I didn't warn her, which was probably a mistake. But her words after this, I think my wife divorced me for. Jeff, you've just found a new way to take my breath away.
Jared, what is your question?
Now you've been at the Carmen's gone, you're safe. Now you've been at the RAC for a little bit longer now. Are you getting any special discounts on your charging now? Are they have you worked out the
Me? Oh, no, I get six months probation. So when I get to my 6 months, I'll get all of the discounts for the parks and resorts. All of the various discounts. I don't think I'll get any more on charging, but, you know, I've been hinting.
The parks and resorts, they're a pretty good discount?
Yeah. I think it's 25%, maybe more.
It's up to 30% depending on whether it's off or peak. But, But everything else is pretty much the same. Like, you know, the EV discount you guys get is the same as the staff discount. We don't get any more than what you guys get. As an EV discount or anything like that.
Oh, I didn't. I thought it was more.
No, so
you would have got there is a charging while you're at work or something.
I resign.
Hey?
So I hear there are some good jobs at Budget Direct, some new openings.
Yeah, they're looking for a tractor operator and a potato planter. There's a few new. A couple of people applied, Yuri. It's interesting.
Anyway, it's late. I'm gonna go. See you guys.
Price is up $50, by the way.
It is, yeah. It's shot up. It hit $1,000 and then it shot up. It's at 1,060 something.
Fireworks.
1,070.
Yeah.
1,072.71.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
And we're back on. If Elon said something stupid so it crashed, I can buy back in. That'd be great. Yeah.
Hey, Jared, I sent my private message you keep ignoring.
Oh, no, I've seen it. No, thanks for that. I appreciate you offering that service. Okay. No, I like my wife's actually going to pick me up, which is very kind of you. But I know you give me a special price on those Uber drivers.
Hey, Jared, obviously, you've probably already said this before. What are you doing in lockup?
That's what it is in lockup. I've been here for 4 days. And I tell you, I haven't been able to leave the room in 4 days, and I totally understand why people go to get quarantined and get stuck in one room for 2 weeks. They go nuts, and I can see why. It's
aren't you in debtor's prison? Isn't that what it is?
Debtor's prison, yeah, it's something like that. So I think the only thing that saved me for the last is this. This is the only thing that's saved me because, you know, just trying to make it work has been crazy. So,
That little doodad.
Yeah, well, I got one. So when Pete's in the doghouse and he's outside on the farm, I've got a few more to go yet, but yeah, we're working on it. So,
when's your release date?
Hey,
when's your release date?
Tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock. Straight out. Wife's going to pick me up and. Home, thank God. I'll tell you, I just said to her, if I get sick again, don't bother taking me to hospital, just take me straight to the morgue. It's not mucking around and just get it done. Because I tell you, getting treated, you know, as a COVID patient, and that's what they did, it was just full on. I just never experienced that. So, yeah, if you go to hospital with a temperature, sweating, and sore throat, and you're coughing and splattering, don't go to hospital because first thing they thought of was, oh, he's got COVID. I mean, all I had to say was I just came back from Hong Kong or something like that, and they would have just shot me. They would just take me around the back and put a bullet in my head. You know, because that were the questions they asked me. Like, I wasn't like, so are you having problems breathing? No, that weren't the questions. Questions like, where have you been? Have you been out of the country? Have you done this? Have you done that? Have you been in any chicken farms? Like all these questions, I'm like, whoa, no, I haven't. No, yeah, it was pretty crazy. So great. The nurses here have been fantastic, though. I must admit, they've been really good. So,
what were those symptoms you described, Jared?
It was, I had a sore throat. I was problems breathing because my lungs were blocked up because of the asthma. And I had a fever, and that was pretty much it, yeah.
So isn't that what you normally experience just walking down the corridor?
No, that's different. That's just getting out of bed in the morning. That's a sore legs and pain and but I did experience a lot of pain when two nurses were in my room at 7 o'clock in the morning. Some back pain, leg pain. And I was quite happy to get my blood checked and get my pressure tested.
So Howard, you mentioned Pete was like potentially in the doghouse and you didn't elaborate on that.
He's always in the doghouse and he hasn't said anything about the yoke. So I feel he's bought, no, I can tell you now, he's bought one and he hasn't told, he's kept it on the, and he's going to, it's what's going to happen. I know his plan, right? What his plan is, he'll say, Merry Christmas, and his two boys, they'll get their gifts. And, oh, look, one of the extra sons got a yoke. I know you wanted the Cybertruck, I know, but you got a yoke instead. And that's how he's just going to smooth it in. I love it, Pete. Mark my words, Christmas Day, that yoke will be on that car. And then you know whose fault it is? Richard Cooper. Richard Cooper, it's your fault. There is 25 people.
Oh, he's the instigator of it all.
He is.
He's the biggest instigator of them all.
Yep, absolutely. Everything he does, everyone's copying. Everyone's doing it.
You know, there are followers and there are leaders in this world.
I mean, every
We're right behind you, Richard. We're right behind you.
You just reminded me, Harold, a few weeks ago when I was first on here, you were saying that if somebody was to take the smart or not smart plunge into getting full self-drive, that you wanted it recorded because it does something fancy. So a couple of my cryptos did some fancy footwork over the last couple of weeks, and I'm now in a position to do it. What do you want me to do? Do you want to do a video for it and send it through you? Or?
Yes, please.
So what does this mean?
I'm just buying the full self-drive. You can do it, obviously, through your phone.
Oh, you want a video of you doing it?
Yeah, right. Showing people how they do it.
Yeah. Because it just takes a few moments, and it's just and you've got to video the screen too as it comes, like as it resets and then goes back on with it. It's awesome.
I shall do that.
Do that. So try and do a screen capture on your phone. So do a screen record. And they get a different phone as you're doing it in the in-app purchase, and try and do it also of the MCU of the touchscreen. So they get a different phone to record that.
Harold, it sounds to me like you need to go over and do it with him. Hold his hand while
he's doing it. No, he doesn't. No, Jaffa. I've spoke to Jaffa today, and I've given it Jaffa Harold's credit card number, so it'll be all fine. And so Harold will get the statement. He'll see it next month.
Corporate Amex is
just obscure Harold's credit card number because that's for Tokwa members only.
All right.
Have you paid?
It's not for the public.
It's not for the public. It's just strictly Tokwa members that need accommodation, urgent accommodation, late airline fares, anything you need. Just
new set of rims.
Yeah, new set of rims. You having a problem making a mortgage payment? No worries, whack that on there. Kids need a few extra presents at Christmas? No problem.
This is beginning to sound like
alimony. Does it cover alimony?
It's all a part of the service. You want a lead? You want some cable? You want anything else? Throw it all in. It'll be announced at the annual general meeting on the 20th at the Newport Hotel at 12 o'clock.
12:30.
12:30. Yeah.
So try and get there for that.
They'll be issuing new cards out to Harold's new credit card will be issued out.
Thought they all just linked back to Elon Musk's recently withdrawn $50 million.
He had a big night. It was a huge night. $50 million,
What kind of position you get to be in where you can turn around and go, oh, well, everyone's pulling the mickey out of me because everyone thinks rich people should pay more tax. So if you Twitter people tell me to sell 10%, I'll do it. Like, come on.
Pretty gutsy, isn't it?
The thing was, he already knew the answer, which was he knew that the vote would be yes.
Yes.
And as Peter explained, actually Rob Mauer, and a shout out to him, Tesla Daily, podcast, and he's also on YouTube, obviously. He's done a really good analysis of that. And as Pete described, what was the strike price of these options, Pete? $6
something. $6.47 or something, yeah.
And it gets counted as income. It's not a capital gain. It's those options are straight to income. So he's got, was a $15 billion tax
bill? $14 billion bill. Yeah, 53% tax rate.
He can get a couple of meals back, though, surely, and some dry cleaning.
Well, a couple of deductions, yeah, perhaps.
There's a couple of deductions in that $14 billion, you know. That small island that he bought for $1 billion, they'll get that back.
Well, anything less than $500 million is a rounding error, wouldn't it? You just round down to the nearest billion. Well, so.
Cool. Yeah.
is he's going to pay the $14 billion because the man is a genius, right? I don't care what anyone says. He's a genius. He's stupid, right? He's an absolute genius. And he's paying that $14 billion on his frequent fly card. Imagine the points he just racked up.
He wants to go to Mars for free.
He's going to bankrupt Qantas in one city.
Let's go to Mars.
Yeah, Starship frequent flyers.
He's definitely a genius, Elon.
Do you know what? Thinking of that now, and one day, Elon, hopefully watch this clip, Starship frequent flyers, you heard it here first at Top of WA. We want to be foundation members, utilising the points that you earn off the payment of the $14 bill.
Actually, there's a secret Patreon supporters level which actually does get you Starship frequent flyer points to Mars.
Along with a large cup of go get fucked.
All right, folks, I'm going to bail out, folks. I'll let you know when my buttons arrive. you can buy four, but you can't buy six at the moment. The six is still coming soon. You can buy four. They'll be here shortly.
Awesome. Don't go pushing all at once there, Shane, because you never know what. And I did notice there was a secret a button that was airbag deployment instantaneous. Just don't press that one.
Yeah, probably would be. All right, cheerio, folks.
See you, Shane. Good to see you.
See you, Shane. It might be I'm off as well, guys. I'm going to go to bed. I've got to get up early tomorrow.
All right, take care, Pete. It might be a good time to wrap up. Thank you, everyone, for having an awesome evening. It was great. A bit fraught audio-wise, but we got there in the end. Big shout-out to Damon, Burnt Orange, Joseph, Ashley in particular, Hosni Mubarak, and everyone else. Pete,
don't forget Joe. Can Joe let us know what sandwiches?
Joe, are the Sangers in the fridge chilling down?
Are they in the boxes ready to go, or what's going on, Joe?
I hope the boxes are in the fridge as well, because you've got to chill the whole thing down. shout out for Joe for vicariously listening and putting up with us, and everyone else.
We miss you, Russell.
Yes, in the fridge, all done.
What are we having tomorrow, Joe?
The same as usual. You can go back to the other YouTube videos and you'll find out. My children have the same thing every day.
Awesome. There's nothing wrong with a little bit of regularity. That's the best way you can put it.
Absolutely.
We are regularly going to go to bed sometime in the next few minutes. So for everyone in YouTube land, please like and subscribe, hit the notification bell. Everyone here, thank you for being here. And everyone watching, Damon and everyone else, hope you enjoy. It was fun doing it. So we'll see you next Wednesday, which will be the last Ask Anything before the AGM. So look forward to seeing you all there too. So, take care of yourselves. Jared, break a leg. Not.
Definitely not.
Testing on other stuff with our little consoles and with buttons.
Yeah, I'll see you in Greylands Hospital with that one.
Nonetheless, my bed, Jared. You'd have my bed. I got out last week.
Yeah.
Good night, everyone. Have a wonderful evening. Great to see you all. Look forward to seeing you next week.
See you guys.
See you guys. See you.